desert and the great American Southwest. I bid you good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be on the planet, all its wonderful time zones covered by this program. I'm Art Bell, and this program is Coast to Coast AM. Glad to be here. It's the weekend, hooray! And it's going to be an extremely interesting program this evening. Next hour, Lynn Buchanan, very famous remote viewer instructor, very famous remote viewer, period, from the government CIA-sponsored program. Lynn Buchanan, one of the greats. And in this hour, we're going to have open lines. That's coming up. But a few things first. I've got a little homegrown weirdness for you. I mean, really homegrown. This involves me and some friends of mine. And fortunately, it's just not me that's going to be telling the story. I've got her here. You know her. Her name is Bonnie Crystal. At least a lot of you probably know her. She's the very unusual lady who traveled to Peru and travels to different parts of the world looking for the deepest holes in the world to climb down into. In fact, one time we talked to her by satellite phone in Peru when she was about to descend into one of the aforementioned holes. Anyway, something truly bizarre happened yesterday, and I guess I was part of it. So in a moment, we'll tell you all about it. This would be a superb time to ask you all what you know about missing time. That's right, missing time. Time that just is gone. Now, here's a little homegrown weirdness for you. Bonnie Crystal and her business partner, Jessica, were on the way from, you know, they're friends of mine. They were on the way from the Bay Area, where they live, down to Las Vegas, here to Las Vegas, to go to the CES show, as so many other electronic junkies are doing right now. It's going on in Las Vegas with all the electronic goodies. And so I was talking to Bonnie, who, of course, is a ham radio operator, on the 40-meter band, and I was kind of talking her in. You know, I think I got her from the time she pretty much left home until she got here, actually, came to Pahrump, and so right in the middle of our conversation, I guess Bonnie and I were talking. Bonnie, welcome to the program. When were you and I chatting? You were just getting to a high point, weren't you?
Right. Hi, Art, and greetings, everybody. It was the day before yesterday in the afternoon, midday, and we were traveling from the central part of California over the mountains at Tehachapi towards Las Vegas and Pahrump area.
Right.
And we got to the top of the mountain, and they have the big wind farm plant there where they have windmills generating electric power.
Yeah, it's incredible, actually.
And we saw all the windmills, and as we got to the top, we were talking with you on the ham radio.
It was you and Jess in your car, right?
Right.
And yeah, you and I were talking on ham radio.
And then you got off for a few moments.
Ramona came in and gave me some lunch. I said, I'm going to get a bite to eat. And so we signed temporarily. And I said, I'll be back in a few minutes. And then I guess the next time I heard you was easily an hour, maybe more than an hour later. Suddenly, there you were. I had been looking for you. I had been calling you, but suddenly, there you were. And so, what happened?
Well, it seemed like only a few minutes to me. But it ended up being 45 minutes or an hour later. And the funny thing is, you can be driving somewhere and not realize that you passed an exit or something like that. But this particular instance, Jessica and I both realized it at the exact same time.
You realized that you had lost an hour.
And somehow we got transported to a place further away than we were actually headed to.
How much further?
Well, it was at least 45 miles or 50 miles away.
Plus, you passed a place where you normally would have stopped for gas and all the rest of it? I mean, where you actually probably planned to stop for gas, right?
Yes, we planned to stop for gas in a little town called Mojave.
Right.
And just so happens that at that particular time they have stoplights and you have to make a left turn. And there's usually a lot of truck traffic and that sort of thing and traffic in town.
So in other words, if you were subject to some sort of road hypnosis, hitting that would have snapped you out of it anyway. I mean, you know, if you're kind of hypnotized by the road and you don't realize where you are, okay, fine. People can imagine that as a cause for what we're talking about right now. But that this would have pulled you out of that quick because you would have had to stop and notice everything around you.
Yes, and I would have had to make a, you know, slow down to a stop and make a left turn across traffic in order to get on the other road. And we don't remember anything about that. And the funny thing about it is, that we both remember nothing during that period of time.
So in other words, from the moment or a moment or two after I spoke to you on the radio and we signed, and then just like a minute later, you were how far down the road?
50 miles down the road.
50 miles down the road. And I guess you looked at each other and said, at the same time, what?
Well, the first thing we noticed was a landmark on the side, which was a new solar energy plant that they built out in the desert there.
Right.
And we thought, have they built another one before you get to Mojave? We knew that you had one down the road past Mojave and on the way to Barstow. But here they built this new plant since the last time we've come through here. And then we realized we were not where we thought we were, because all of a sudden we started seeing landmarks for a little place called Kramer Junction.
Kramer Junction.
And we said to ourselves, how can we be in Kramer Junction? Kramer Junction is after Mojave. And it was right at that time that we heard you on the radio and talked to you on the ham radio.
And the first thing I think someone asked me was, hey, something just happened to us out here. Something like that. It was you or Jess. Is Jess there with you?
Yeah, she's here with me now.
Put her on for just a sec.
Okay, Jessica.
Hi, Art.
Hi, Jessica.
Hi.
Okay, so your account of this experience, roughly the same, of course, but you both realized this at the same time?
We realized it when we went by the power plant, and I said to Bonnie, I said, how far up the road is Mojave? And she said, well, it's just up the road a bit. And then we turned up to Kramer Junction, and I said, wait a minute, Kramer Junction is after. Oh, my God, what happened to Mojave? And then you came out in the air, and I think I told you, Art, something very strange has just happened.
Yeah. And so, Jessica, what do you think happened to you?
I have no idea. I'm a physicist, so I'm supposed to understand these things. And the strange thing is that Bonnie and my memories of getting off the radio with you ended at the same time, and our memories of the power plant started at the same time, and I was fully awake. I was watching the scenery, waiting for Mojave to come along to gas up and get a soda. And it is absolutely no memory. It's like someone cut that 45 minutes out of my life.
You're not a strong believer in the paranormal, are you?
No, I'm not. I believe in the physics of the world, and
yes,
things are supposed to operate a certain way. They're not supposed to happen like this.
Uh-huh. But they do,
and they did.
And it happened the day before yesterday.
And it shook me up, as you remember when I was talking to you on the radio. It was a definitely earth-shaking experience. This stuff's not supposed to happen.
But it does, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. I can attest to that now, and right now I'm getting goosebumps telling you.
Well, I really appreciate the two of you coming on there. They had to go grab a hotel room telephone somewhere or another in order to come on the air and even tell this story. They're in Las Vegas at the CES show. How is the CES show? Is it really cool?
It's packed with people. It's very interesting. Video is definitely the hot thing. HDTV is everywhere. And as you know, with your new HDTV, everyone's going to have one in a couple of years.
It'll happen. Just as black and white went to color, this will happen.
And it's a stunning difference from color.
Oh, yes. Well, I want to thank you, and I want to thank Bonnie for coming on the air, and it'll probably spark a conversation. I have no idea what happened at that time, where you might have been. You've checked your body, haven't you?
First thing I thought was, in fact, I think I mentioned to you,
because
something like weird happened in the middle of the afternoon along a highway, because it's wasn't even nighttime.
Yeah, in broad daylight, two individuals who pride ourselves on being scientists.
We're scientists. This stuff doesn't happen to us. We hear about this, but to experience it is spooky. And I'm sure some of your listeners have experienced this also.
In reflection now, the two of you don't think it's possible that just some simple old road hypnosis could have done this.
I wasn't watching the road. I wasn't hypnotized by anything.
Yeah, and the other thing is, Bonnie was speaking with me, so there was a lot of external stuff going on.
And we were both well-rested, and we both just had lunch, and it's the middle of the day. Those are not hypnosis periods. You know, in the evening, on a lonely road at night, you can understand that.
Yeah, I'm with you. Well, congratulations, and welcome to the club, both of you.
There's more things in heaven and earth, right?
I guess so. Thanks. And good night. That's Bonnie Crystal. And Jessica, and I'll tell you, we'll hear from Bonnie again. She's going back down to Peru. She's a caver, on top of doing what she does in Silicon Valley. She's a caver and looks for truly the deepest holes in the world. But there was an experience worth hearing about. Now, I had my little part in it, in that I was talking to them and noted the passage of that amount of time, certainly, and called them, and they weren't there. The question is, where were they, or when were they, or whatever? So maybe some of the rest of you have had some sort of experience with something like this. I don't know. But I thought I would toss it out for what it's worth, and it is certainly worth something. Quickly around the world, British soldiers and Iraqi police clashed Saturday with armed stone-throwing protesters in southeastern Iraq, killing six people. U.S. officials unfortunately acknowledged that American soldiers mistakenly killed two Iraqi policemen after they failed to properly identify themselves, and in Fallujah, all nine soldiers aboard the helicopter, the medevac helicopter that we now know was shot down. Did not fall down. Well, it did, but it was shot down. An American Airlines commuter flight diverted Saturday, another one, after a passenger passed a note to the crew demanding to be taken to Australia. The plane landed safely instead at Washington's Dulles Airport. It's cold in the Northeast. While the climate change is real, certainly I'm sure that the people in the Northeast don't want to hear about you're going to hear about it, though, global warming. It's very cold right now. NASA's Spirit rover has now fully unfolded itself and stretched up to its full 4'11" height. That's a small person, I guess, making it ready to drive off the lander that has delivered it to Mars. And the rover space agency says it might reach the Martian surface as soon as Wednesday morning. Now, we've got to talk about Mars for a second. There's good news, and then I guess maybe some bad news. I don't know. A data acquired on Mars from the Mars rover Spirit's mini thermal emission spectrometer shows that light or spectral signatures of an as-of-yet unidentified material that contains bound water. That's water, folks, in its crystal structure. Minerals such as gypsum and zeolites are possible candidates. If water is indeed bound inside crystals underground, well, then it once flowed freely on the surface, meaning there's a very large chance there once was, and maybe still is, life on Mars. Now, there's something that I want to say here, which will probably be not good news for Richard Hoagland. I've really spent my time on the Enterprise mission site, and I have looked at all of what I could find of what were considered to be anomalous photographs, and there is one thing of a snake maybe. It sort of looks like a snake, or an animal like a snake with its mouth open and eyes and stuff, right? But I got to tell you, what I mostly see up there are rocks. Rocks. I could nearly go into my backyard here or very close by and take a photograph out here in the desert and show you just a similar scene. Now, you know, I don't want to step on any toes here, but I don't see it, baby. I just don't see it. I see weird-shaped things. But when you have a field full of, or even a horizon full of weird rocks and shapes and things on Mars, you're going to end up with stuff that looks like stuff. I mean, it's really akin, in my opinion, to looking at the clouds and finding your little puppy dog up there. Ooh, look at your puppy dog. You know, it's like that. You can find things in things, and when they're not fully distinct, and when they're only partially distinct, and they are awfully good photographs, but, you know, by the time you get down to rocks and stuff like that, you begin to get a little fuzzy, and if you look at those photographs, I guess you can see things in them that that you want to see. I mean, the mind does that. Now, I know there will be strong protests from the ever passionate, very passionate, verbose Richard C. Hoagland. But I've looked very carefully, and I'm sorry, I see rocks. Now, that doesn't negate the possibility there's life on Mars, certainly, and now with the discovery of water, it's ever so likely there is or was. Probably both. But I don't think we landed in the middle of a machine shop or wreckage of a civilization, which I've seen some evidence of in satellite photographs that look below the immediate topography on the top of Mars. I'm willing to say those are very suspicious, but these new photographs from the rover, wonderful as they are, look like rocks. Now, there is some weird stuff there, you know, where the rover hit, you know, it boom, 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 bounced, right? And apparently, where it bounced, it exposed soil that was stripped up and folded in a very interesting way, according to Jim Bell, a spokesman, right? The scientists just can't wait to get there. They want to dig into the area where the rover bounced. They say, quote, it's bizarre. Steve Squires said that, principal investigator on the NASA team. It's strangely cohesive. It's not like anything I've ever seen before. It's weird stuff. That's a quote. And so there's plenty of interesting stuff to explore in this crater on Mars. But once again, being absolutely honest with you and Richard and everybody else concerned, honestly, I've looked and I've looked at the photographs, and yes, you can see shapes. I mean, given millions of rocks, and there are obviously millions of rocks there, right? There's going to be some weird-shaped rocks. Hell, I can go out in my backyard here and go to Death Valley, and you can get a scene just about like that, and you can come up, you go, ooh, look at that. And it's a really oddly shaped rock. And in a photograph, as you look at images and blow them up and do all the rest of that, you begin to get images that the mind will then attach meaning to, because that's what the mind tries to do when it looks at any image. It tries to attach a meaning to it. It's the human thing to do. We have brains, and our brains go to work, and they try and recognize something in the incoherent madness that's out there. That's what minds do. It looks for something it recognizes. And beyond that, I see nothing. Nothing but rocks and rocks and rocks. I'm Art Bell, and this is Coast to Coast AM. everybody. Remember, the phone numbers change on the weekends. You know, the week has some phone numbers, and we share some of the week, and then we have other ones on the weekend. So listen very carefully.
To talk with Art Bell, call the Wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM. With Art Bell.
It is, and we'll go to the phones shortly and see what you have to think about all this. Those are the numbers. Stay right where you are. Open lines directly ahead. And now, from the high desert into the gene pool we jump. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Yes, I was looking at the latest images from Mars.
Ah, yes.
And I found three of the images that looked like they had something like a UFO in the air.
A UFO in the air?
Yeah.
On Mars?
Definitely.
Okay.
And I'd like to have somebody explain it. I just...
Well, I would, too. I haven't seen... I can't say that I've seen what you're talking about, but...
Okay. I can tell you how to go there.
Well, send me an email.
Okay. I sent you one of the fast things, anyway.
A fast blast.
Yeah.
All right. Well, is it in there? Is the URL in there?
No, I don't know how to do that on my computer.
But, okay. Anyway, well, all you have to do is right-click and hit copy. And then go to Fast Blast or anywhere else and right-click again and hit paste. And boom, it'll appear.
Okay.
All right?
Well, I'll do that. Thank you very much.
That's a quick lesson in how to transfer a URL. Copy and paste. Right-click. Wildcard line, you are on the air. Hello.
Hello?
Hi.
Hi. I was wondering if anybody called in. You have an explanation for that Bonnie with where her 50 minutes went.
And where, pray tell, did her 50 minutes go?
Well, Highway 58 between Barstow and Tehachapi doesn't go into Mojave anymore. You got to exit off Highway 14 to get into Mojave. Now they completed a bypass.
Oh, really?
That whole highway was under construction, and she's right about when she was going by the windmills there on Tehachapi.
Yes.
Well, about 45 minutes later, Wood put her about the truck stop there at Kramer Junction.
Well, maybe that's where her runaway hour or whatever went.
Well, the first time it happened to me, that whole area was under construction.
Well, you know,
I came up with, ma'am, I've got a,
you're in a truck right now, I take it, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I've got a friend who's a truck driver, and we were talking with him as well yesterday, and what really scared me was... His name is Tim, friend of mine, and he was down in New Mexico at the time, involved in the conversation to some degree, and he said, oh, yeah, that happens to me sometimes, too.
Well, yeah, all of a sudden, when you're going, when it first happened to me, I was going westbound toward Bakersfield, and all of a sudden, I seen a scale house, and I thought, well, what the hell happened to Mojave?
Yeah, no, I don't mean so much in that exact thing, but missing time. Have you ever had missing time?
Occasionally, not often.
Occasionally, but even so, like as I told Tim, that's a little scary. If people in 18-wheelers, you know, the big ones, are missing time, then what the hell's a truck doing in between? Well, maybe that's the answer, a bypass. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. I keep having these occurring disappearances. For instance, a couple of weeks ago, I had something on the top of my medicine cabinet. I have three shelves there.
Yes.
I had a plastic little handle that fell off the mirror. I kept it there for a long time.
And then, what are you saying? Poof? It was just gone?
Well, what happened is I went to reach for a pair of scissors next to it. I got the scissors, and the object fell. It never hit bottom. I saw it go down. Till this day, I can't find it. And this is not the first time these things have happened. I've lost a button off my coat in my hallway. The kitchen was ripped apart because of renovation, and even the radiator was taken apart, and I figured, oh, maybe now I'll find my button.
Well, I must admit, things do disappear, and they seem to go to the land of the lost, but then occasionally, some years, like you'll move something, sofa or something you haven't moved in years, and you look behind it, and you go, oh, wow, look! Well, that's where it went.
Well, that's what I thought about the button that fell off my coat a few years ago. They ripped the whole kitchen apart because they were renovating. The counters went, the radiator went. I figured I would find my button then.
No
button. Nothing. Never to be found, ever.
Gotcha. Well, then, see, maybe on the other side of the coin, things do disappear. I mean, they just disappear. What do you suppose might occur to them? Maybe they slip into a little tiny hole into another dimension where they're never going to be found again. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Cheerio.
Yeah, hello, Art.
Hi.
This is Michael, listening to 550 KFYI in Phoenix.
Yo, Michael.
I wanted to call about the debris field around the rover.
Yes.
And, you know, I don't have a computer. I haven't seen the latest pictures, but I've been listening every night and had heard everyone describe what's there and
right.
Great detail.
Oh, yes.
And I've come to a conclusion as to what it is.
Well, but that's awfully early for you to come to it. I mean, without...
Well, I may have a new outlook on this, though.
Okay, I'm listening.
Okay, well, it's... With all due respect to Richard, I think that is debris from the Earth. And I believe that what it is where, over all these years, all of our lost airline luggage has been going.
So we're back to the lost again. Yeah, and maybe a few other things, too. Who knows? Maybe they go to Mars.
Well, you know that skull? That could, if you've ever seen a beagle skull.
Yeah.
And that grid there, that could just be a rusting...
Well, here's the challenge that I think that I'm going to do, and I've been threatening to do this for a long time. I live out here in the middle of the desert, right? And trust me when I tell you that nearby is Death Valley, and I'm telling you right now, I could take pictures of parts of Death Valley that would not be different than what you're seeing right now.
Oh, yeah, Robinson Crusoe on Mars, the movie.
I'm darn well thinking of doing it and then picking out little bunny rabbits and hammers and buzzsaws and stuff like that.
Oh, I agree. I live in the desert, too. I desert rat at times, and you're right.
So I'm going to do that. Thank you. As a test, I'm going to do that. I'm going to take a picture, and as I was saying at the bottom of the hour, with all good deference to Richard, I think people see what they want to see. And then if I were to say to you, oh, look, there is a picture of a hammer lying there right in the middle of the Martian desert, and it did look like a hammer, then your brain would look at it and say, whoa, hammer. And so having looked at the photographs myself, I mean, I didn't go just on comments received at all. I looked very carefully at all the photographs. And yes, of course, you can begin to see shapes. The human mind forces you to do that because you're trying to identify something. And so, hallelujah, you do. And so I understand how it's happening. But honest to goodness, looking objectively, I can't go, wow, that's not a rock. I'm telling you, I see rocks. International Line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. How are you doing tonight?
I'm just fine. How are you?
I'm pretty good. I actually had a question. I was surfing around the internet a couple nights ago, and I came across this guy's site, William Cooper.
Bill Cooper, yes.
Who is this guy? Why?
Well, in the past, Bill Cooper is dead.
Oh, is he?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Yeah, because he didn't have a lot of nice things to say about you.
Oh, I'm well aware. He thought that I was involved with the secret government. Let's see, the secret government. He thought that I was a Freemason and a lot of other stuff. All kinds of things he thought about me. And as evidence, he cited a triangle with an eye in it that somebody once put up on my website.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. I saw that Art Bell.
And so all I can say is, like the rocks on Mars, I guess you'll believe what you hear or not. Anyway, that story on Bill Cooper. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello. I'm doing okay.
Well, this is Karen, and I'm a truck driver, too.
Uh-huh.
And the other lady took the words right out of my mouth about Tehachapi.
The bypass.
Right. The same thing happened to me. I got 20 miles down the road and realized where's Mojave?
What happened to Mojave?
What happened to Mojave? But I was going over, taking a friend home, going back towards Palmdale there. But I've had a few strange things happen. I remember on your past show, you talked about Mandela.
Oh, well, yes, that a lot of people have the memory that Nelson Mandela died.
That I don't remember, but during that time period in the 70s, when I graduated from high school, we had a teacher that I swear up and down had died, and I went to her funeral.
Oh.
10 years later, we had a class reunion, and I was discussing this with one of the students. I said, boy, we're really going to miss her, and next thing I knew, she walked in.
That's got to be a little unsettling.
And I think it was during that same time, and that has been bothering me for years until I heard that show, one of your shows a couple years ago or a year ago, about
this phenomenon. Well, it's actually, thank you, it's actually a lot deeper than that because of what it would mean. And here's the basic theory, that a lot of people, for example, have the memory that Nelson Mandela did not not serve his jail time and then get out and go on to lead South Africa, but rather died. And it's not just, that's just one example. There are many other examples of seemingly false memories that people have. Now, what could these be? Well, if there is eventually to be time travel, and I believe there will be, if we live, if we survive as a race to gain the technology, I think we'll be able to travel in time. I really believe that. And so there could be time travelers. And it may well be that if they in some way tamper with the fabric of time, or there's some other anomaly that tampers itself with the fabric of time, then things perhaps do get switched on about as experimentation and tampering occurs. And things occur one way, and then time makes them something else. And so we have these weird little memories. Just a possibility. Wildcard Line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes. This is Michael from Waterbury.
Yes, Michael.
I happen to be listening in on the Mars thing.
Yes.
And I was intrigued. I brought up my computer.
Yes.
And a lot of those things look like just faces that are like from some statue that fell over or something.
Yeah.
It's over to the right, there were some that looked like they got a long nose and a kind of a flat helmet instead of a round helmet.
Right.
And that little snake-like thing looks more like it's a pipe from a tractor or something because...
Yeah, I mean, you're right. See, we could go on with this until... You know, until the time itself ends. So you're sort of with me. I mean, it looks like this, it looks like that, it looks like a lot of things, and that's what our brain does. It tries to take random images and make sense out of them. So, I'm just not convinced, that's all. I think they're rocks.
I like the gears behind that little snake-like thing.
I appreciate the call, sir. Thank you. I know... I looked at the snake-like thing, and I don't know. Rocks. East of the Rock Keys, you're on the air. Hello.
Hey.
Hey.
About lost time.
Yes, sir.
One time I drank 2/5 of whiskey, and I lost 2 days.
Well, that, of course, is a self-inflicted time loss, isn't it, sir?
It certainly was. Thanks.
You're very welcome, and... try and stay with us. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello. This is Olin in Culver City, California.
Yes, Olin.
A couple years ago, you had a heavy windstorm in Pahrump, Nevada, and it was bringing in dust and dirt from Mongolia and the...
That's a fact, yes.
And the Gobi Desert.
Yep.
Now, that's the same kind of land deflation that they're seeing there in that Mars crater. And if the dust has been blown away in the Mars crater to expose buried objects, then there must also be some exposed buried objects in Mongolia and in that Gobi Desert. Now, David Childress has been on your program a couple times, and
yes,
he explores places like that.
Mm-hmm.
And now, with all of that deflation in Mongolia and the Gobi Desert, there might be a few artifacts or dinosaur eggs or something to find there in the Gobi Desert.
Well, you know, they do look for example for meteorites, and they go to dry lake beds and places like that to look for meteorites or anything else because, yes, indeed, there's a great deal of exposure that occurs just due to wind and dust erosion. And besides, that kind of empty area is just a good place. A meteorite would stand out. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Wow, really?
Yes, wow, really.
Well, this is Brad in Davenport, Iowa. Is this Art?
Yeah, see, you see, Brad, we don't screen calls, so you just go on the air just like you just did.
Wow, amazing.
Mm.
Well, you know, I was calling. It's kind of a weird question. I'm a logical person. I don't know, I have a tendency to doubt some of the things I hear on the show, but I figure you, of all people, would probably have a good answer for this. What do you call having a dream about something and then a period of time later actually seeing it?
Or I would probably call that precognition.
That's precognition.
Yes.
Well, I mean, I guess I'm a skeptic and everything. I'm in law enforcement. You know, I sometimes think I'm losing my mind, but I have dreams periodically. They're nothing significant. It's, you know, not the death of anybody. It's nothing important. It's almost random.
Well, like life, you would think that would be the case more times than not of a precognitive dream. Why would it always be of dramatic events? It might just be of an event, something.
Right.
Yeah.
And I had one here the other day that was just, you know, like I said, I'm in law enforcement. It's damn scary, to be quite honest. Because it's like, what comes next? I just, it's like two pictures that are out of focus.
All right, what was it?
It was, you know, I can't really go into it a great deal because it was on the job. But basically, I was at a location. You know, the dream when I had it was nothing significant. It's nothing that I remembered. You know, I had very lucid dreams.
Right.
It was nothing significant. But when the day came and it happened, It was literally like two images coming into perfect crystal clear focus. Everything made sense. I recognized the individual I was speaking with. The truck, I had a book, a log book on the truck. I mean, I recognized the location, which is a very unique location. It's a secure location. I mean, it was absolutely amazing. And it's like, am I losing my mind here? Is this something that I could learn to control?
Do you talk to your partner? Have you mentioned this to your partner, to others in the department?
I mentioned this to my partner, yeah.
You did?
And he's actually my twin brother.
How did he handle it?
I asked him, you know, I said, hey, you know, I want to ask you something here, and don't think I'm nuts, but have you ever had a dream and then seen it? He's like, yeah. And it was the most casual thing.
Well, it's because the human brain can do stuff like this. I mean, it's a fact. I got to go. The hour's ending. Thank you very much.
Not a problem.
All right. So there's a police officer, and, you know, it's the police, and everybody has these experiences. There is much more to this life than is apparent on the surface, isn't there? And even policemen and firemen and public officials, they all know it. We just don't talk about it except right here.
Goes to walk.
with Art Bell. Call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
It is, and somebody just fast-blasted me. I hadn't looked at the front of the Coast to Coast AM .com website. Seems as though somebody named, Tim Shepard has done a cartoon of me with a big old silly grin on my face and super glue, and that's a comic memory of something that happened to me a number of years ago on the program, which I'm sure most of you know about. It didn't quite happen the way it's illustrated there. It looks like I was just holding up some super glue, gluing my lips together. It didn't happen that way at all. I have this cart rack next to me on the wall here. Yes, I still use carts. I'm a dinosaur in the radio age, and I have a cart rack here. You gotta love these old things, you know? And the cart rack, the little Molly came out of the wall, and I was right in the middle of a break, you know, doing a show like I'm doing right now, and so I ran into the other room and got the ever trusty super glue, which I'm no good with at all. I don't have talent with super glue. And anyway, I came in and attempted to apply some glue to the Molly to get the thing back in the wall, right? Sensible. The problem was that, of course, I coated my finger in super glue, and then I tried to chew it off. You know how you try to chew the glue off of your teeth, right? Well, the problem was that super glue wasn't, it wasn't hard yet. So what happened, basically, is I glued my lips together, which is now, I guess, kind of humorous, but in retrospect, it wasn't very funny, because when you're on the air, you have to talk, and that means you have to use your lips. You must use them. And so being in a panic to help myself out instead of, you know, finding some remover or something like that, which the normal person would have done, I was running short. I had like less than a minute to go to get back from the commercial set. And so I ripped my lips open, upon which, and at that time, well, then a little piece of my lip came off with the glue, which then ended up in the ashtray, and that was the, and then I was trying to talk with my lips still partially. It was just, you know, it was not funny at the time. I understand, in the spirit of the Leland Gregory type stuff, it's funny to hear about, but talk show hosts gluing lips together, well, I guess to you it would be funny. The Seventh Sense. The Seventh Sense. That's the name, and that's a cool name, too, of Lynn Buchanan's new book. That's really a cool name, The Seventh Sense. That's neat. I'm going to ask about that. Lynn Buchanan was one of the U.S. military's controlled remote viewers from 1984 through 1992. During that time, he worked first as a viewer and then as a database manager, trainer, training officer, and property book officer. Upon retirement, he worked as a computer systems analyst at the DIA, Defense Intelligence Agency. He then began his own computer data analysis company called Problem Solutions Innovations. When the CIA finally declassified the existence of the military's remote viewing effort back in 1994, it became public knowledge that Lynn had been the unit's trainer. He was, of course, quickly then overwhelmed with applications for training. About this time, he began the Assigned Witness Program, which uses trained, experienced, controlled remote viewers to do pro bono remote viewing work for police and other public service organizations. The original intent to help police find missing children. However, as cases met with success, The various departments and agencies began to enlist the remote viewers in other projects. Presently, Problems, Solutions, Innovations continues to work with both public service agencies and the corporate world to train and make use of talented and qualified controlled remote viewers. Lynn has written about his experiences and what he learned about the human mind in a book entitled The Seventh Sense. Lynn Buchanan, hey, I really like your book title.
Oh, well, thank you very much.
That's pretty neat, The Seventh Sense. Do you think that Lynn, that's exactly what it is?
Actually, I believe it is. It's sort of a combination of the sixth sense, actually, is ambiance, sort of combination of all the other senses. You know, you walk into a church and you get that hushed feeling, or you're on the edge of a cliff, you get whoa, you know.
And, there's a definite church ambiance, sure.
Right, and it's a repeatable thing. You can test it. It's always there. And as a result, I think it's the sixth sense, and the seventh sense is the psychic sense.
Okay, well, that question I want to tackle alone, you said you really think it's always in there, that humans have always had this innate ability, whether it was sleeping in their minds or active, as in the remote viewing program, but it's always been there. And
I think it has. You know, there's evidence of it all the way through history, and not just the history of civilization, but also through the histories you get in jungle lore and such as that. I mean, it's always been around. It's always been there. It's a natural thing.
Wouldn't most normal people confuse it or not be able to delineate between that and the sixth sense? In other words, some sort of psychic capability.
Right.
It would seem the same to the average person.
Yeah, in my course I teach methods for developing both of them. And the method for developing that sixth sense, that ambiance sense.
Yes.
You know when you're doing the thing right. When people start saying to you, what are you, psychic or something? because you start seeing things in your environment right around you that is available to them, but they don't see it. They're just sort of dead to the world in that.
But Lynn, aren't they mixed? I mean, you look at some of the most talented psychics, and they make really good remote viewers. I guess not always, but one of your own members there in Las Vegas, I believe, is quite a talented psychic.
Is that Angela?
No.
Oh.
The greatest of...
Yeah.
help me here. You must know who I'm talking about.
In Las Vegas?
Yes, I believe he lives in Las Vegas. Doggone it. Well, it'll come to me in a moment.
Are you talking about Dean Radin?
No, I'm not. And doggone it. Anyway, somebody will blast it to me, I can assure you, in a few moments. At any rate, he's a very, very talented psychic, and apparently quite a remote viewer. So they do sort of mix and match a little bit, don't they, if you're
Yes, absolutely, they do.
Okay.
The psychic sense is your ability, the ability of your mind to pick up things around the world. The controlled remote viewing, which was used in the military,
yes,
is actually not a psychic method. It's a formulation of methodologies that allow you to control that ability. One of the biggest problems that natural psychics have is they don't have control. Well, what the military wants is control over everything, of course. And so, all things have to be uniform. Everybody has to do the same thing the same way. And so they actually developed a method whereby you can gain control over your psychic sense.
Ingo Swann, Lynn.
Yes.
Ingo Swann. That's what
I'm
trying to think of.
This one is the developer of this method.
Yeah, exactly. But he had, I'm told, that he had enormous psychic ability, natural.
Oh, he's good. Yeah, he's really
natural
good.
Psychic ability. So do you think then that really, I guess the delineation between the two is the control?
That's it. And like I say, the controlled remote viewing that we teach, in fact, remote viewing itself is a methodology only to use the talent that you already have. It doesn't develop talent within you that's not there. It just develops the talent that is there.
And different people have different levels of natural talent in that area, yes?
Oh, sure, yeah. You hear me play chopsticks and you hear, you go to Bourbon Street and hear some of those people play on the piano who've never had a lesson in their life, and that becomes quickly evident.
Lynn, how do you test for a level of natural psychic ability? Is there any measuring stick or standardized test you can use?
I think there have been several developed, but basically what we do is we, the proof, you know, the proof of the pudding. What we do is we can put pictures in envelopes as a basic test.
Right.
And then give someone simply the cueing of, you know, I want you to tell me what picture is in the envelope.
It's the target, right?
It's the target, right.
The target, all right.
You tell them nothing more than that, and then you see what they can do.
As the person who assigns the target, are you aware of what the target is?
You don't have to be, but you can.
Well, yes, but I suppose the problem would exist no matter who assigned the target. But the question will always hang about whether there is a telepathic communication between the mind of the person assigning the target, whoever that might be, and the person searching for the answer.
Oh, I don't think there's any question about it at all. It's absolutely there.
Oh?
Yeah, it's pollution. And if the person assigning the target wants you to find a certain thing, it's been shown, you know, through testing and databasing that the viewer will tend to find what the what the tasker wants them to find.
Yes, yes, but you called it pollution.
It is pollution.
Pollution. Yeah. So you're saying the real method is indeed remotely locating and actually seeing what the target is, not a mental pollution coming from the person who assigned the target.
That's right. About half of the rules and protocols that we use are not to get information from the target. It's to control pollution and to get you around that pollution so that you can weed out the bad stuff.
And how do you do that? I mean, how do you generally search the ether like you'd search the internet on Google or something for a specific item?
Mm-hmm.
And not know where the source of your information is from? How do you mentally delineate?
Yeah, it's sort of like calling up Google and typing in surprise me and see what happens. actually, there have been all kinds of theories about this, and the final answer is that all of the theories sound good, but none of them have really held up in practice. And the bottom line is that no matter how expert you get, nobody really knows where this comes from. The one that is held up most is the fact, well, is the theory that your subconscious mind sort of sits right on top of the collective mind and can gain information from it that is not normally accessible to your conscious mind.
Have you been watching the research, Lynn, on consciousness, mass consciousness, the Princeton stuff and all the rest of it? Have you been monitoring all that?
With Dr. John and
Dean Radin's work?
Radin's work.
You've been watching all that carefully? What do you think about all of that?
Oh, it's I think it's becoming very evident that there is a collective unconscious or a collective subconscious or what I call the collective conscious. And that the collective mind is there, and once you learn to access it, and get past all of this pollution that you normally put into the process.
Yes.
There's no secrets. Anything in time and space, or you know, is basically available to you.
No secrets.
Oh no.
And that means across time, the past, the future, the present, they all mix together in what you view.
Sure. One of the things in the control remote viewing is that in all respects, we treat time and space exactly the same with the same rules.
Huh.
It's just as easy to say move back 10 years as it is to say move back 10 feet.
So when you access this, the parallel to Google seems like a pretty good one, is it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You put in a subject, something you want to know about, and you're going to get good returns, and you're going to get things that are not perhaps relevant to what you really wanted.
Absolutely right. And also, you know, you say, well, how does Google do that? Somebody may know, but I don't.
Well, it's just Google searches every website on the planet. And
how does it do that?
It does that that's what computers do. And
that's what our mind does as well. You know, you tell it the target you want, and it somehow searches.
Yeah.
And I guess God wrote the program on this one, but it somehow searches and comes up with the information. It comes up with a lot of garbage, but it also comes up with the information you need.
But, Lynn, I know the practical applications of remote viewing. You know, locating missing children, obviously, that kind of thing.
Sure.
And I know you've done that. But if that's the kind of access and the kind of field that you can fire questions at and make inquiries of, then can't you begin to ask this great Google of the... of God's world, some of the questions that we all want to know about our own existence, about how we got here, who we are, so many of the questions a little child might ask that you literally in remote viewing could probe.
Absolutely, and I think that everyone who gets trained in this and experienced in it winds up asking those questions. I have seen very few people who have followed this conscientiously and who have practiced and done their practice and done their work.
How could you not?
Who have not grown
yeah.
tremendously in the process.
How could you not? How could
I don't
you, once
see,
you
how
realize you, that these kinds of questions can be probed, I don't know how you could resist probing them.
Well, I certainly couldn't.
Now, I've... in the military program, when it was going on, there were certain excursions, perhaps, from officially designated targets. Is that fair?
That's extremely fair. we sort of put them under the label of practice sessions. However, we tried at all times to get those targets which would have feedback. Because we wanted to database the results, and we wanted to find out on things like UFO sightings and all that. We wanted to find out if we could do it, and therefore we had to have feedback in order to learn whether we could or not.
Yes. All right. We're here at the bottom of the hour. Hold on, Lynn. Lynn Buchanan, who is a remote viewer, was involved in the CIA's remote viewing program, is my guest. And if you're new to remote viewing, you'll be interested. If you've been around it for a while, you'll still be interested. Don't touch that dial.
Be it sight, sound, smell, or touch, there's something inside that we need so much. The sight of a touch, or the scent of a sound, or the strength of an oak roots deep in the ground. The wonder of flowers to be covered and then to burst up through tarmac to the sun again. Or to fly to the sun without burning a wing.
to lie in a meadow and hear the grass sing. To have all these things in our memories haunt, and they use them to help us.
Take a ride. To talk with Art Bell, call the wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
He was one of the CIA's remote viewers during that program. He's written a book now called The Seventh Sense, and his name is Lynn Buchanan. He'll be back immediately. Well, all right. Once again, here's Lynn Buchanan. You're not a licensed remote viewer guaranteed to know what the future holds, are you, Lynn?
No one is, no.
All right, listen, a point of confusion, perhaps, before we go on. You know, your bio lists you as a training officer in the remote viewing program.
I was the training officer for a while, as well as the trainer.
Because Ed Dames also says he had that in, you know, that was in his, too.
Yeah, when he came into the unit, you know, he claims he was my trainer. I had been training and was the training officer and the trainer when he came into the unit. He was in line for a promotion to major, but he needed to work in a major's slot. Well, training officer is a major slot, and so I very gladly gave up slot to him.
Oh, I see.
And so he became the training officer. I still stayed the trainer.
Gotcha.
It's one of those small worded things that makes a difference in the military that may not make a difference to anyone else.
Okay. Well, while we're on the subject of Ed for a second, Ed seems to have... You know, when we're talking about being able to virtually ask any kind of question, the really deep ones we all want to know about, Ed seems to have gone down more of that road than perhaps anybody else, you think?
That is a very seductive road,
yeah.
And many people go down it. The one problem with it is that you have so much pollution in the process that you mm-hmm. have really got to know whether or not what you're finding is true.
And then there's that nasty timeline thing, right?
That's right. And, you know, if there's no feedback, then you can't know that. But now that we're in the computer age, you can keep a track record on known targets and find out over hundreds and hundreds of sessions how good you are. And how accurate you are on questions of, let's say, the color of an object or the size or the shape or something like that. Then when you do one of these, what's called esoteric targets, then you can look back at your track record and say, well, I can't prove it, but I can prove that I'm right 90% of the time.
All right. Mark in Tucson, fast blast me a computer question. I can get these questions while we're on the air. It's pretty cool. He says, and I don't know if this is true, Aaron Donahue, a remote viewer of some renown, readily says remote viewing is a cult in nature. Fallen angels, demons have the answers, many deceptive and misleading, others true and based on their immense knowledge. That's pretty heavy duty. Do you know if Aaron has that view, that it's somewhat occult in nature?
There, I think he has that view.
He does, okay.
I think also, from what I've seen on the Internet, his name is mainly bandied around by him. But from what I've seen on the Internet, he holds that, and he is trying to come up with something that is better than remote viewing and will outmode it. And, you know, I wish him success.
Interesting. Now, being completely honest with us, have there ever been moments for you, Lynn, during a remote viewing session where you have felt any sort of, dark force influence that you questioned something that could be darker?
Yes. One of my strong points was to access people mentally. And we got an awful lot of targets of people who were, well, like Saddam Hussein. The man's totally crazy.
Is he?
And he's crazy in a very dangerous way. He's not irrational. He's just under the delusion that God wants him to rule the world. And he's really confused that not everybody else can understand that because, I mean, God wants it. And so he's out to follow God's plan.
You know this of the mind of Saddam Hussein because of remote viewing?
Been there, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Really? I would imagine yes, an irresistible target. And so he's got that delusion he wants to rule the world.
Yeah, well, it was an assigned target for us.
Oh, an assigned target? Even that far back?
During the Gulf War, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, that leads me to this. If remote viewing works, Lynn,
mm-hmm.
then we just came off condition orange in the country. Terrorism is the word and the worry, and we're all frantic, that's the wrong word, conscious of the real danger of terrorism.
Yeah.
And so you would think there'd be application for remote viewing, heavy, straight-on application about terrorism in the United States. And,
well, there absolutely is.
Well, if there is, then doggone it, why don't we have an active program? Or do we?
Every question, I've heard that there are two questions that have answers in Washington, D.C. One is that... One is, where is the only place in Washington, D.C. where people know what they're doing? And the answer is the bathroom. And two is that the answer to every other question you can ask in Washington, D.C. is money and politics.
Yes.
And the money and politics of the situation, right as we moved into the Cold War from the active war, you know, moved out of the Cold War, that situation was such that everyone in the intel community was right on the verge of losing their jobs, and slots were going and money was going.
Yes.
And what project are you going to cut? Well, there we were.
Well, that seems like a satisfactory answer then, but not now.
No, it's not. And in fact... I was in Lower Manhattan on 9/11, on the morning of 9/11. It's 4 blocks from the building, standing there watching it fall. And when I finally made it back home about 2 weeks later, I was still so angry, and I contacted the people that I knew personally who would be handling the task that we're going to be given. I'm picking words here carefully. And
you contacted some old friends.
Some old friends, yeah. And they were eager to use us. The president then came out with the thing of think outside the box. And so many of the agents called
and actually used us.
Oh.
Now, that is not to say that the United States government officially used our services.
This is saying that agents who were concerned with this did use you on their own?
And
question
that's
mark?
Right. That's right. And agents who knew about us and so on did. However, that does not mean that the government used us officially. There's quite a distinction there, and you have to be very careful on that one.
Well, there probably is a distinction there. But you know, you do have to wonder if they weren't, well, let's see, what did they know and how much did they know and when did they know it and whether the boss of the agent knew and there was a wink and a nod and really it was a semi-official official thing.
Oh, sure, yeah. Well, those are questions that at that time I just really didn't care to ask.
Well, all right. Well, then here's a good one. Okay. Since 9/11, lots happened.
Yeah.
But there has not been another major terrorist attack, biological, chemical, radiological, whatever, on the United States. It's gone pretty darn well, amazingly well, actually, in this time. And one has to wonder, well, gee, why has it gone so well? Maybe the terrorists just haven't done a damn thing. Or on the other hand, maybe our agencies, who never get the credit when they do prevent something, have acted. What do you think?
I would tend toward your second one.
You would?
Yes, I would. Uh-huh.
Well, okay.
A lot goes on in the intel community that never reaches the public and never will.
All right. So would you imagine, Lynn, that some of that action that has been taken without our knowledge was supported by information gleaned by remote viewing?
I would say that some of it may have, yeah. In fact, there have been indicators, as I watch the news, there have been indicators that that some of it has. And probably more interesting, when we actually invaded Iraq,
yes,
there were indicators there that Saddam Hussein, who may be crazy, but he's not stupid, you know, had developed a remote viewing force of his own.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah.
Out of curiosity, you don't know anything about, I mean, a man who had a vision or a whatever, that he was destined to rule the world, ended up at the bottom of a dirt hole in a rather undignified manner when captured. And you wouldn't think somebody with a delusion of world leadership would end up in a dirt hole.
That's life. yeah, you know, I've wound up some places that I didn't expect before in my life too. So, but no, I am 90% certain that the condition of Saddam Hussein just even a week before, he was not living in a hole. He was protected and went to that hole in the ground because the troops were coming in,
right,
and because there was imminent danger. But as far as
still not
hiding in that hole the whole time, he wasn't there. No.
Yeah, not living the life though of one who would rule the world.
Oh no, not by a long shot. Mm.
Now, I've heard a number of things since, that his body is eaten away to some great degree, fatal, ultimately, degree of with cancer.
That could be. I haven't looked into that, but I think it could be.
There is a report of that he has a gland-type cancer, which will probably kill him before it, you know, the results or verdict of a trial do. So, yeah, you know, but he's now sort of history in a way.
Right.
And here we are as a nation concerned with what's going to happen. Now, I'm sure you've taken a look or tried to take a look down the road in terms of terrorism. Is there anything you see ahead for us, a bit of a bump in the road somewhere up there?
Well, actually, I do. They have not made their last attempt by any means. I think there would be an awful lot of situations where
they will rattle sabers and, you know, let information out into the public and then do nothing simply to keep us stirred up.
That's what terrorism's all about.
Sure, that's what it is.
The terror part of it, the not knowing, the being concerned. But I mean in terms of actual occurrences, things that could... Well, maybe we should get into the nature of remote viewing. Once you have remote viewed something, let's say that you remote viewed two buildings coming down or airplanes plowing into buildings, something of that magnitude.
Sure.
Is that an inevitability, or is there some way it can be changed?
The future is very changeable.
It's malleable.
It is. And, in fact, there have been times already when we have seen the future and have been able to do something about it. This is one of the beautiful things about the fact that time and space can be treated equally.
Well, beautiful as it may be, it's probably also very troublesome for people like yourself, because if you successfully call a problem and screech from the rooftops about it, and then it doesn't happen because something changed it, then you look like you made a prediction that just didn't happen. And,
sure.
And yet your prediction really is what prevented its occurrence.
Right, and that has happened many times. And
it ruins your record.
Oh, I don't worry about that. I worry about the people who were saved and, you know...
Yes?
I can sit smug and think, you know, I was beneficial in this one place.
Is there any way to tell when you look at an event how whether it has a certain degree of inevitability, you know, a high degree of inevitability, or is everything equally malleable and changeable if you need to change it?
I don't know of anyone who has found a way to tell those. I have an analogy that I use about the pond of time. You're a bug sitting on the pond of time, and you see another bug across the pond.
Yes.
Sitting beside a rock, and you think, oh, that would make a good meal. You go skittering across the pond, and you set up waves in front of you.
Right.
And those waves can scare away that bug. But when you get there, that rock is still going to be there. There are rocks in the pond of time that we're not going to move. And, you know, everyone has always said that if you change one thing today, then it changes the entire future. Actually, it seems to just take the path of future off at an angle, and it slowly curves back to that next rock in the pond of time.
Really? So, as we move forward in this, this now like going down a road in time... There are certain things that are going to happen almost no matter what. In other
That's
words,
right.
if you were able to manipulate something else would be manipulated to bring us right back to the same rock.
But that doesn't mean that you didn't manipulate the one thing. I like to liken it to playing chess with God. You can pull off some smart moves, and you can really, really, you know, capture a few men and all that. But in the end, he's going to win the game.
Well, it is a little like playing chess with God, and there are those who would suggest that you're not supposed to do that. Play chess with God. I mean, it really is so close that it's better than an analogy. You might actually be doing that. In a way, you're playing chess with God.
It could be, but then, you know, if you're not supposed to do that, why get up in the morning?
Well, I guess every morning you get up, you play chess a little bit with God, huh?
That's right.
Oh, I never thought about it that way. So, in other words, as much God-given ability to play chess as we have, we should be able to play.
We should.
All right. All right, Lynn Buchanan, who was one of the CIA's best at remote viewing, just told us, if you listened carefully and read a little between the lines, that there may have been some unofficial but official... mostly unofficial remote viewing going on about terrorism, what's going on right now in the United States. Maybe that's why it's so quiet. From the high desert, this is Coast to Coast AM Weekend Version.
Coast to Coast. some velvet morning when I'm straight. I'm gonna open up your gate and maybe tell you about Phaedra and how she gave me life and how she made it in. Some velvet morning when I'm straight.
Flowers growing on a hill, dragonflies and daffodils learn from us very much. Look at us, but do not touch. Phaedra is my name.
To talk with Art Bell, call the Wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
This song just seems to fit. It sets a mood. Secrets. No secrets in the world of remote viewing. It's what we're talking about tonight with Lynn Buchanan, actually, and we'll continue in a moment. Well, this is pretty cool. If true, Judy in Orange, California, fast blasts me the following. As your guest was in New York City prior to the actual moment of the 9/11 attacks, did he sense that anything negative was about to happen? One. And apparently, it's also of the Seventh Sense, his book. The first chapter, I guess, is available up on the web. Lynn, is that right?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
A whole chapter of your book. Oh, well, there's a good way to find out if you want to buy a book. A whole chapter.
I have always believed in try it before you buy it.
That's really generous. Okay. Where?
It's at secretsofremoteviewing.com, and that's all one word.
Secretsofremoteviewing.com. Well, I think people can get there, and I'm sure we probably have a link or something like that. Cool. One whole chapter. Okay. This is sensitive stuff. I guess it's all sensitive stuff we're talking about, but it long ago occurred to me, Lynn, that if you could remote view, then maybe you could also remotely affect the mind of another person.
This is true.
Now, you see, yes, but when I asked a lot of remote viewers before about this, they either said, well, I don't think so, or we don't do that, or
absolutely.
We don't talk about that, or one of the above.
Right. There's a lot of hemming and hawing going on there.
You bet.
The reason I was brought to the unit by General Stubblebein was to do remote influencing on computers, on enemy computers.
Okay.
Congress had pretty well put out an edict saying, not no, but, you know, expletive deleted no,
uh-huh.
You will not do mind control, and that's what they saw it as.
And, well, yeah. You mean they believed enough in it to actually say, don't do it?
Oh, yeah. We were sort of told, I was told the first day that I got there that that under no circumstances would I ever do anything like that, and that General Stubblebine had put me there in error, and therefore
I was to become a remote viewer, but I would not do active mental work.
What do you mean put there in error?
He wanted to put me there to do mind control, basically, on enemy computers.
Oh, so that was his intent, but
his intent.
Right. So that was that regarded as your specialty?
Yes, because of some incidents that had happened previous to that.
Oh.
But those are still partially classified as well.
Well, let's see how much we can find out.
The thing was that they told me, I mean, that first day, you know, you will not do that, and we don't do that here.
We don't.
And so on. And so from the first day, it was just understood that I was to be a remote viewer instead of a remote controller.
Okay, let's go back before that a little bit. Obviously, you had a rep for being able to do remote influencing, and how did you get that? I mean, how did you? What do you know about remote influencing? What have you done, and what can be done?
Well, actually, I didn't know that much about it. It was just sort of a natural talent that has always been there, and it came out one fateful day when I got just absolutely flaming angry and sort of cost our government several big dollars for computer equipment. And I didn't know at the time that this General Stubblebein, who was our commander, you know, of the intelligence forces,
yes,
had people out who were trained to spot these events. And so, you know, I wasn't going to...
Are you telling me you got angry and that anger manifested itself by ruining some computers? Is that what I heard?
And as a result of being reported, General Stubblebein found out that I was doing that. He came out and got right up in my face, and he said, "Did you kill my computers with your mind?"
Really?
And I was, you know, I was seeing my grandchildren still paying for computers, and I sort of heard this little voice coming out of my mouth saying, "Yes, sir, I did." And this scowl that was on his face.
Oh, I'm sure, but even before that, I mean, did you know that you did it? Did you know when you were doing it?
Did
you know how you did it?
Yes, I've been doing things like that most of my life.
Why were you that angry?
I had written a computer program, and this other guy had trashed it on the day that I was to show it to the generals of all of the 12 nations who had equipment and operations there where we worked.
He destroyed the program?
He gimmicked the program so that the minute I started working it, it would bomb. It would bomb out.
Oh, he sabotaged your... Oh, now that would make you very angry, yes.
Yes, I had spent a good 8 months writing that program, and he did it on purpose, and as soon as it bombed, I looked up, and, you know, the generals were chuckling and all this, and he was standing in the back of the room, and he pointed his finger at me and mouthed, "Gotcha." And I got just flaming angry, and I know better than to do that, because of the incidents that have happened in my life, and yet it was uncontrollable, and sure enough, many millions of dollars worth of computer equipment went down. And like I say, I wasn't about to tell anyone that I had done it, because they would think I was crazy.
Do you know what happened to those computers?
Well, basically, they just kind of fried.
They fried. Millions of dollars worth of computers fried.
And so, anyway, when I was standing there in front of General Stubblebein, he, his scowl turned into a big, wide grin, and he said, "Have I ever got a job for you?" And pretty soon there I was in Washington, D.C., in in a program that I had never heard of. And in fact, when they told me what the program was, my first reaction was, I'm on candid camera, right? Because, you know, I didn't believe the government would have any kind of a program like that.
Well, sure, if you can destroy an enemy's computers, that's big time.
It does seem kind of like a useful tool.
Done with a virus or a mind, doesn't matter. But could you muster the kind of destructive power it took at times other than when you had that manifested amount of anger?
No, I haven't been able to do that.
Oh, really?
And this is one of the things that I would have been doing, was to be there and find a way to develop this ability, to develop control over the ability, and one day hopefully teach it to someone else.
Well, look, you know, an awful lot of paranormal occurrence, like things flying through the air, and
sure,
things associated like that seem to be associated with young teenage girls with hormones right through the roof, who are just going through an incredible period in their lives when they're just so pumped with hormones and emotion is through the roof, and that's when these things occur, and it sure sounds kind of like that.
Yeah, that's what it is. In fact, that's when it started happening to me, is in early teens, and I was one of those poltergeist kids, and I found it extremely fascinating, and actually back then found a way to control it.
At least until you got to the computers.
Well, no, until... I've always had many parallels to...
Or did you intentionally destroy those computers?
No, I didn't.
So it's not totally controllable.
No.
Mostly controllable.
In growing up, my life was quite a bit like Charlie Brown's, and I was trying to impress the cute little redheaded girl one day, and... come to find out, her father, the Pentecostal minister, was interested in what I was doing and met me the next day as I was going home from school, asked me to show him what I had shown his daughter, and when I did, he and three of his deacons who were with me just had me down on the sidewalk screaming for the Satan to come out of me. And
you're dating his daughter?
No, I wasn't dating his daughter. I would like to.
Had interest in his daughter?
I was just trying to impress her. You know, cute little redheaded girl.
Well, if Dad thought you had this kind of power and knew you were interested in his daughter right away, you're probably possessed anyway, as far as he's concerned.
Well, now that you come to think of it, you know, I don't think I would like my daughter doing that either.
well, with an influencer, no. But boy, that ability certainly would have application in those areas, no question about it.
Well, yeah, it would. You know, for the first time ever, this talent that had appeared and that I thought was so neat, for the first time ever, I started questioning whether it was maybe evil or something.
Well, if people of the cloth are above you trying to drive out the devil, that's going to send a message.
Oh, yeah. I was raised in East Texas, and, you know, if the preacher says it, then God said it, too.
Well, that could have almost stunted your growth as a remote influencer slash viewer, couldn't it?
Oh, absolutely, it did.
Event like that?
Yeah, I fought it for the rest of my life until that incident. And then one day, here comes this this general and gets right up in my face. And because I told the truth of what happened, I wound up in D.C. As a remote viewer.
but then with orders to do remote influencing as well, ultimately, right?
Those were his personal orders, but they were basically canceled because... we were not allowed to do any active mental work.
Is it possible to thought control a person any place on the face of the earth? Is that possible?
The possibility is there. You have to be so good and so well trained and so experienced that... all of these people who say they can do it, they can't. And remote influencing is just that. It's influencing. You know, it's probably even more subtle than putting a red label on your product in order to influence people to buy it.
Could you, for example, let's probe a little, could you, for example, influence the president of the United States to want to renew the U.S. space program? Is
sure.
that the kind of influence you could apply?
Sure, you could do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the possibility is there. The possibility for misuse is also extremely great. I find the whole remote influencing question to be sort of distasteful. And
it is.
I mean, I know how to do it. I developed the protocols for it.
Distasteful and irresistible.
No, not irresistible at all. I found out the hard way that what goes around tends to come around. And no, it's not irresistible at all.
Well, you say what goes around comes around. Are you suggesting to me that there's some kind of cosmic law? I mean, after all, people into witchcraft, into the craft, certainly believe that what you do can come back to you times whatever. Is there really something like that?
I believe so.
Oh, you do?
Yeah. I mean, we live in a... I certainly believe in the collective consciousness. And we live in that collective consciousness, and when you start hurting other people, you're going to wind up hurting yourself because you're, you know, especially if you're in close touch with that collective consciousness, then you're going to hurt yourself just that much more.
Okay. Lynn, I got so fascinated a few years ago with the possibility of millions of minds concentrating on an event occurring.
Right.
That I experimented 8-9 times on quite a number of times on the radio with a worrisome amount of success. I mean, we produced rain in areas where they were rain-starved. There was no forecast of rain. Damned if we didn't make it rain. We did some experiments, Lynn, that scared me. Really scared me, because I began to play in a field that I didn't know. I was like a kid in a candy store, and we played with all kinds of things I'm sure we should not have played with. It scared me, and I don't understand the nature of it, but it would appear as though millions of minds concentrating on an event to occur can seem to influence it. You believe that?
Oh, I absolutely do. Dean Radin has gone into that type of experimentation. Also, Rupert Sheldrake. In his, well, a lot of people call it the 100th monkey theory.
Yes.
And, I mean, he's got well-developed documentation and proof that, that sure, this can happen.
Well, okay, I talked to Dean Radin about this, and I expressed at that time caution, and I was very concerned about it because I didn't know what unexpected results I might get. And when you're tampering with very large forces, unexpected results could conceivably be unpleasant. You could really do something you don't mean to do or have an effect somewhere else. And so just not understanding the nature of it, I withdrew from it and I stopped doing it. And I'm still at that point now. And I said, Dean, should I be concerned about this? Not really worried or freaked out, just concerned and cautious and stopping until I understand more about it. He said, absolutely.
Absolutely.
You agree with that, too?
I absolutely do. Yeah, you know, oops, when you're swinging a hammer on a nail is one thing. Oops, when you're doing something on a global basis.
Yes.
You don't want an oops at that time.
No, you don't want an oops. And there could be an oops, right?
Oh, absolutely, there could, yeah. It's very easy, in fact.
All right. Lynn Buchanan, stay right there. Listening to somebody who was in the CIA program, the U.S. government CIA remote viewing program. I'll remember that nightline till the day I die, when they admitted all that went on with Ted Koppel and invented all that, and millions of dollars spent. Whew. From the high desert in the middle of the night where it belongs, this is Coast.
Keep to Laura contemplating a crime. She comes out of the fun and a dumb dress run like a watercolor in the rain. Don't bother asking for explanation. She'll tell you that she came in the air of the cat.
To talk with Art Bell, call the wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Well, Mars is certainly in the news right now, isn't it? All kinds of fascinating suggestions about Mars, despite the fact that I see rocks right now. That aside, hey, folks, there's water there. That's what they're saying now. Perhaps even a lot of water, and there was an atmosphere, and there could well have been a lot of big life on Mars at some time in the past, so I think Lynn may have done some work in this area. In a moment, we'll ask about it. Stay right there. Well, all right, an obvious question that I want to clean up here. Lynn, you were in New York and actually saw the buildings get hit.
That's right.
So, you know, the minute it happened, Lynn, I got a million emails, of course, saying, okay, so where were all the psychics? Where were all the remote viewers? Well, you were right there.
Right.
So, an obvious question is, did you have any immediate foreboding? Did you have any idea it was coming, or were you as shocked as all of the rest of us when we turned on CNN? What?
Well, I hate to admit it, but I catch myself doing this many times. The night of the 9th, my wife and I were pacing back and forth out on the patio saying, don't go to New York. Something's bad. You know, don't go to New York tomorrow. Don't go.
Oh, really?
And, you know, it never seems to dawn on me that we have a remote viewer in the house, and maybe I could find out why. And sure enough, I didn't. So the morning of the 10th, I started off for New York. I was supposed to get there at 2 in the afternoon because planes kept breaking down. I finally wound up on 5 planes that broke down in the process of getting there.
5 planes.
And
there's
finally
a message.
Got there about 1 in the morning, and still had this, you know, foreboding feeling of don't go, but I figured, well, the plane's breaking down is why I shouldn't have gone, and so that's probably what the feeling was about. And sure enough, the next morning I found out what the feeling was.
Wow, that's really something. So I guess like a carpenter's house is never finished, a remote viewer just doesn't look around himself or use it to his... I mean, that is one of those things. I've been there with my wife when we say, you know what, this feels wrong, we shouldn't be doing this, we really shouldn't. If you feel... In fact, my wife and I have said, if you feel poorly enough about doing this trip and you feel strongly about it, let's turn around and go home.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And then you keep going.
That's right. We've always kept going, but we have come to that question. And so when a remote viewer gets to that point, you would think, voila, you'd be right on it. But no, huh?
Well, no. In fact, it's actually part of our training. We basically did not do remote viewing until we were tasked. And so, you know, people ask me, well, have you done such and such, you know, and have you done the JonBenet Ramsey? Well, no, nobody tasked me to. At the same time that the JonBenet Ramsey case was there, by the way, there was another case almost exactly like it. All of the psychics in the nation were
scrambling to get some publicity by, you know, solving that case. And this other police department down in the South, there was a young colored girl who had been killed about the same way, and that police department was begging for some help, and we helped them, and that case got solved.
Well, all right. I'd like to understand how the 9/11 event was missed by the world's greatest psychics and remote viewers. I really would like to understand that. You would think such an event would stand out in the immediate future of humanity like a gigantic sore thumb. I mean, the event,
I would expect so, yeah.
An event of that magnitude would be monstrous in the collective.
No, I would think so.
So, I mean, the question's there. How could something so momentous be missed?
I wish I had an answer. I keep kicking myself, you know. Why didn't I sit down and figure something out? I'm not sure that anybody would have done anything about it if I had. But at the same time, I keep kicking myself thinking, you know, surely I could have gotten this. Surely I could have found something out.
No, but there is no question, Lynn, that if you had gone ahead and remote viewed that with an eye toward your trip to New York, and then you had written it down, or, you know, had witnesses that you said this was in our immediate future.
Sure.
You'd be, I don't know what you'd be right now. You'd probably be behind a closed door somewhere in some government building or something. And you'd probably have been questioned a whole lot.
Yeah.
A lot of things would happen to you, I suppose.
Yeah. However, to be fair about that, there have been other instances where we have been tasked and have come up with information that would show that something was about to happen, and we have turned it in, and as a result of taking action on it, the thing didn't happen. Mm-hmm. And it gets back to the problem like you were talking about earlier.
And it is a big problem. Credit for things not seen, good things not seen that protect the American people. There is a lot of it. People need to know that. And there's got to be a reason why we have not yet been attacked again, not to say we won't be, but a lot of time has gone by, and you would think retaliation would have occurred had it been easy, so something must have been in the way. People with information, stopping it, whatever.
Well, there may be some people working out there. I can tell you, actually, though, that I know this for certain. Anyone who says that they are officially working for the government as a viewer is not being exactly truthful with you, because the government is not officially using any remote viewers in any of the agencies of the government.
Well, you know, I've heard the Chinese might be having a program.
Oh, yeah. Well, those
governments,
I mean, I'm talking here about the U.S. government.
Oh, I realize that.
I'm
building, though, to a point. I mean, if our enemies have it, and if it really works, which you're assuring us tonight it does, and every night you've ever been on, then what the hell's wrong with us? I mean, if our enemies have it, that's too much of an advantage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's as though, you know, we suddenly stopped using radar and said we don't believe in radar, so we quit using it, but every other country in the world had it.
Exactly.
Money and politics, you know. Some people ask me if the government is still using it, and my pat answer is, well, I certainly hope so. They quit telling me things when I retired. I certainly hope they are, but, you know, they would be stupid not to. And, of course, that changes the question from are they using remote viewers to does our government ever do anything stupid?
Has it occurred to you that perhaps one reason our government might not be using remote viewers, this might not be a commonly considered reason, would be that in tasking the remote viewers, you would have to give them enough basic information so you might be able to discern some of our government's biggest secrets, because what they would task you with would involve their biggest secrets.
There was, I believe, some fear along that line,
Mm.
In fact, you know, we did get raided a few times for some of the things that, for instance, Joe McMonagle found out, drew the inside of the absolutely most top secret product that they were building, Area 51 type work, and actually drew an accurate picture of the inside of it.
See,
and
they would hate that.
Oh yeah.
And as a result, what?
We got raided.
You got raided.
Yeah, they tried to arrest Joe and cart him off to jail for spying because they knew that no psychic could do anything like that, and sure enough, he did.
Wow, I had never heard that.
Oh yeah.
That's some raid. Well, how did it come out?
I wasn't there at the time, but they quickly called downtown and got the people to vouch for the fact that it had been tasked to us, and that there was no other way the information had come, and that it was witnessed. And so,
you would think that the filing of a report of that magnitude alone would reinvigorate the program.
Well, there was what was quite often called the I forget how many martini lunches, seven martini lunch,
yeah,
that people would see the information we had gotten and found out how we had gotten it. And lunch that day was solid martinis or solid alcohol of some form.
Oh, yeah. Oh, all right. Look, Mars is big-time news right now. We've got the rover down. We're getting these photographs back. There is wild...
By the way, on that, let me congratulate you for being sane and cautious here. I've been listening to your comments, and I'm very impressed with your ability to stay rational on this.
Well, that probably means you agree with me.
I'm keeping an open mind, but I tend to agree, yeah. Uh-huh.
Well, there is a lot of controversy. I mean, there really is. I've dealt so long now with pictures of things like ghosts and what people perceive as apparitions, and frankly, a good 10% of them I cannot explain, and I've posted many of those up. I mean, just inexplicable pictures of what I thought were inexplicable, but the 90%+ that I cast off, I know damn well it's a lens reflection, or I know it's this, or I know it's that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of like Mars now. It really is a pretty good parallel. I mean, gosh, you know, you look at a million different images, you do close-ups on rocks, and I don't have to repeat all this, but they do look like pretty much like rocks to
sure.
me. But you've done some work on Mars, haven't you?
That's right, yeah.
Uh-huh. It is, after all, pretty fascinating. Gee whiz, water on Mars, it looks like for sure now. Water and at one time an atmosphere, that's the stuff of life. And so it seems like there's some possibility that there might be an ancient civilization, or that life of some form might have been or might be now on Mars. What do you know?
That's what we found as a collective group in the unit. Now, this was not officially tasked to us, but that's what we found, that there had been an ancient civilization there.
Really?
That, pretty well just died off because of the climatic changes.
Huh.
And we gave descriptions, and in fact, one of the descriptions that I gave of one of the life forms, I was extremely surprised when they found that Mars rock up in the Arctic, and they found the little microbial looking things in it. That was the sketch I had drawn. And
a sketch of a microbe?
Well, I didn't know it was a microbe at the time. I had done a session. See, we were never told beforehand what we were doing, what we were being tasked with.
But that was it, life on Mars?
Oh, yeah. That was one of the life forms that we found on Mars, yeah.
Do you recall the highest in the food chain that you observed?
Was civilized and
wow.
And had buildings and structures and things like that, yeah.
Aha. Uh-huh.
This was many, many, many centuries ago. I mean, this was not recent history.
I understand. Do you have any sense of what happened to Mars?
Basically, the climatic changes caused catastrophic changes in the ecosystem, and it wouldn't support life anymore.
Yes. One of the reasons that a lot of people don't like that scenario is because you get headlines like I'm looking at right now in Nature, came out today, it was on CNN today. The headline is Climate Change, Extinction, a Threat to 25% of Animals. And
yeah.
What they're basically saying is that our climate here on Earth is changing so quickly right now that unless something changes, a quarter of all species on Earth will be extinct, perhaps within our lifetime.
Sure.
This is serious stuff.
Well, it's serious stuff. It has a domino effect. I mean, think of the human lives that that's going to
affect,
take as well.
I suppose so. Now, I don't think we're on the list offhand, although maybe to some degree in terms of increased mortality we are. I don't know.
Yeah, but what if, you know, what if one of the life forms that goes away is the grasses? Then you don't feed the cattle, and the cattle, you know, humans, and
I know.
So it's a domino effect.
I clearly see that, and I've been screeching and yelling about this for years now, this climate change, this rapid climate change that now they're coming to believe indeed can occur and has occurred, and may be occurring right now. In front of us, in our lifetimes. You usually think of these things, you know, in long geologic terms, and you don't worry about it in your lifetime, or maybe even your child's lifetime. It's somewhere out there. But they're talking about our lifetimes, 25% of all the animals on Earth. The oceans are increasing, the ice decreasing in the north and the south, and the world is changing really quickly, and not too many people are paying attention.
Sure. Well, you know, how many mammoths have they found with green grass still in their stomach while they're embedded in ice?
A whole bunch.
Yeah, and, you know, that didn't take place over millennia. That evidently took place during lunch.
Yeah. Now, see, if it can happen on Mars to the degree that we're up there looking at nothing but the debris of what was, then it can happen here. And then when you read the headlines saying, basically, it is happening here, it is happening now, people just don't like that. It's scary.
Well, if the people who don't like it just find the solution is to turn off the TV, then it's going to continue happening.
Which I might add, they do a lot of that.
Oh, sure.
When people see something that either scares them or they don't agree with because they're scared, that's what they do.
There's always a rerun of Friends you can watch instead.
That's right.
Yeah.
Exactly correct. It's just the nature of the human to want to reject that kind of material. And so I take, is that one of the reasons that Ed Dames will talk about some very dire things he sees? Starvation, for example, mass starvation.
Yeah, the doctor has been talking about that for years. Yeah.
Climate change, that kind of thing. Radiation from the sun, that kind of thing.
talk with Art Bell. Call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Those are the relevant phone numbers, and shortly we're going to begin taking calls for Lynn Buchanan. So if you have a question about remote viewing, some of the cool stuff you've heard about tonight, some of this has been actually very new stuff, then you get on the phone and I'll connect you with Lynn shortly. Just a little word here. I was holding this. I was thinking tomorrow night. I'll hit it tomorrow night, too. But this is so non-trivial, something I usually don't release on a Saturday. But sure enough, it came out in Nature and hit the news everywhere, CNN, everything else. The headline, Climate Change Extinction, a Threat to 25% of Animals. A quarter of land animals and plants. A quarter, 25%, could be driven to extinction by another 50 years of global warming, scientists said today. The stark warning follows a major study into the likely effects of greenhouse gas emissions on 6 biodiversity-rich regions around the world. It found that by 2050, even a medium level of climate change threatened to wipe a million species off the face of the planet. Between 15 and 37% of species could eventually become extinct, the research found. Averaging out the findings resulted in the predicted disappearance of a quarter of land, animals, and plant species. Higher levels of global warming led to a third of species becoming extinct. That's really sobering stuff. That's out in Nature today, and it bears directly, I guess, on what we're talking about. So, Lynn Buchanan, we'll be right back. I wonder, Lynn, whether you have looked at this enough to know whether what's happening to Earth right now is some variation of what happened to Mars.
I don't believe it is. I think that was more of a natural thing. But we really didn't look into causes. To find that out.
And well, I mean, it's such a the atmosphere was virtually stripped away. The water, such as it was above the planet, if it's there, is still there, is below the planet or whatever. I mean, that's extremely radical, and there's no large life walking around anymore. So something pretty traumatic had to have happened, I guess.
It could have been the same thing that happened, you know, when they think the planet Venus is what stopped the Earth's rotation that one day in biblical history. And that may have stripped an atmosphere away. I don't think there's a way to know scientifically.
How do you feel about how do you feel about the Bible and then what you have remote viewed in the past? Have you ever tried to verify through remote viewing anything that the Bible tells us happened?
Oh, yeah. And in fact, there's a lot of absolute truth that's, you know, much of it is masked with religious terminology or with religious interpretation, and yet the truth is still there. And the Bible is a good book. It's a really valuable book and has a lot of information that that we need and that we can go by. I wouldn't write that book off in a long time. You know, it has a lot of potential.
I've had some reason to speculate on where I'd go in the past if I ever got a chance to travel in time, and my answer has always been the same. To the life of Christ, I would want to go to the time of the life of Christ and verify it for myself. Have you ever ventured forth into such a question?
I was given a task one time. I had been doing bad guys and accessing them mentally, doing plans and intentions, and as well as personality assessments, which is a deeper access. And I had gone in to complain because, I mean, it was really tearing me up doing all these bad guys, because you mentally associate with them when you do. I went into my boss and I said, you know, I can't take this anymore. Give me Mother Teresa or Bozo the Clown or something, but, you know, I can't take this anymore. And his answer was, you know, you're a soldier, suck it up and do your job.
Yeah.
And, you know, get out of my office. And I guess about a week later, I got a target, which was just a personality profile type thing. And I went into it to do my job. And the minute I started the session, I got this sudden awareness, and I said to my monitor, whatever evil you think this guy did, he didn't do it. You know, you've targeted me with the wrong guy.
Hmm.
And we went on through the session, and finally at the end of the session, I was just glowing inside. I'd never met any person like this, and I actually accessed this person's mind, and just came up, the experience was a life-changing experience. And of course, when the session was over, he said, okay, well, let's see if there are any further questions. He opened the envelope and pulled the thing out. And our director had taken a sheet of paper, and right in the middle he had written the word Jesus. And that had been my target that day. And that one session was a large turning point in my life. I think it was Courtney Brown one time said, you know, you met Christ at that level. What did he tell you? What did, you know? And the only answer I could give was, Courtney, when you've met Christ at that level, he doesn't have to say it. You know, he doesn't have to tell you anything, you know. And, I mean, it was a real life-changing experience.
All right. You remember you told me Saddam Hussein featured himself as someone who would be running the world?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How would you know whether the mind you had read was somebody deeply delusional or the real McCoy?
I think when you get to the depth of his delusion, it becomes the real McCoy. I think you're asking, though, you know,
how would you tell the difference?
How would you tell that God doesn't want him to run the world?
Well, no,
wouldn't be gained in remote viewing. That would be gained by just observing what goes on.
But when you're dealing with having met the mind of Christ,
right?
I just wonder how you know it's the mind of Christ versus somebody who's delusional and believes it's a fairly common delusion, actually.
I see. Because that was the target.
And you don't miss the target.
That's, you do at times, but that one I didn't miss, no. I stress a lot of times the need for training and the need for control and the need for track records and the need for databasing and so on.
Yes.
I stress it sometimes to the point where people say, oh, well, he's just trying to make a living because he's a remote viewing teacher. But that's not it. I make a very good living aside from the teaching. The need for training and the need for establishing with hard targets that you can faithfully, you know, as often as humanly possible, hit the target and describe it.
Yes.
That need is there. It's part of the training, and it has to be. I see people who go for a one-day course and workshop in remote viewing, and they come away and they immediately go out and try to save the world by finding missing children and all that. And they, in the process, they tend to destroy themselves as well as everyone else.
There would be no way to meet with the mind of Christ and have that experience and not have it profoundly affect your entire spiritual belief system in life and, I guess, everything, huh?
I don't think there would be, no. And I was not doing a plans and intentions session, which is a deep one where you get the actual thoughts and everything. I was just doing a personality assessment on this, and so it was actually a shallow one, and it affected my entire life from that point on.
Profoundly?
Profoundly, yes.
Ed had an encounter with Lucifer.
Well,
I suppose you've heard about that one, huh?
Yeah, I heard about that one. Huh?
You, on the other hand, very interesting. Wow. There have been some fearful encounters that you've had, because that's a word you used here, is fearful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so how do you handle that? I mean, when you're in a remote viewing session and you encounter something fearful, is it a very palpable kind of fear? Do you fear it as though there were a dangerous animal stalking you, you know, the hair up on the back of your neck, or what?
Oh, yeah. And there are degrees of remote viewing, and there are degrees of sight contact which go along with that. If you have what's called the perfect sight contact or the bilocation experience, and you have one of these experiences, then you can, I mean, it's extremely real, and you would have the same fear and actually the same trauma as though it happened to you for real. Fortunately, most remote viewing sessions do not go into bilocation, and so you still have that detachment, and you can still realize, well, that's the target. This is me.
Is it possible, it is possible, I guess, then, for a remote viewer to actually be in a place?
Yes. Let me give you an illustration. One of my students had been wanting to have this bilocation experience, and I kept saying, you're not ready for it, you're not ready, you know, just be patient and all that, but he kept being impatient. Someone gave him a target of a man drowning in mud and being swept away in a mudslide. And I was working with a group of students over in one side of the room, and the student ran over and said, you've got to come over here quick. Somehow he had bilocated into that person and was struggling for breath. He couldn't breathe. And it got to the, you know, I knew what was going on because I had seen the bilocation experience before, and I thought, and I'm not proud of this, I thought, okay, buddy, you wanted this, then, you know, we're going to let you do this, and I'm going to pull you out when it's going too far. And right at the last minute, I pulled him out. He had come to the point where he knew he would not live through that session, and he had come to the point in that session where he had accepted his own death as being imminent within seconds.
Do you believe, had you let it go, do you believe it would have brought physical death?
Oh, no. He would have passed out completely, and then the fainting would have broken him from the target, and he would have regained consciousness.
Okay.
However, there are other things. You know, I have come out of sessions with a broken rib and things like that. So there are those dangers and possibilities.
How, pray tell, does one get a broken rib in a remote viewing session?
I like to think, I'm very practical, I like to think that when I access the person who just happened to be breaking his, in an accident at the time that I was accessing him.
Yes.
And broke his rib, I like to think that my muscles tightened up to the place where my muscles broke my own rib. I am not into the magic stuff, and so I look for logical, plausible explanations on all of this.
So you're saying this happened to you, and the way you dealt with it mentally was to just sort of say it's the power of the mind.
Yeah, uh-huh.
if the power of your mind can break your rib, then maybe the power of your mind could keep your windpipe constricted to the point where you wouldn't get enough air and would die.
Oh, yeah. This one particular student would have passed out from lack of oxygen. But, of course, that would have broken him from the target. And then he would have regained consciousness.
Huh.
But he was in dire straits. He's sort of a big, burly guy, and he sat there the rest of the day crying. I mean, just shaking and crying. He had had an experience that he did not want to have.
And that's bilocation.
It's called bilocation, and it can be a very dangerous thing, especially when you bilocate into another person.
Huh.
And that's always a thing I try to guard my students against. Before they ever get to the ability where they can do that, I teach them the method for getting out of the situation.
Question.
Yes.
Is the bilocation person aware that they're being possessed?
The target person, you mean?
Yes.
Thing about controlled remote viewing is that if it's done correctly, there is no way the target person
would be aware,
ever sense you or be aware of you being there.
I'm sure that would be the motive in military applications or
sure,
whatever. Sure.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons it was selected.
But in such an out of control thing as you just talked about.
Yeah. Well, this was a beginning student of doing the magician's apprentice type thing, trying to,
yes,
you know.
No, sure. Yeah, but is it possible that under those uncontrolled circumstances, the person, I suppose not in that circumstance, when you're in the middle of dying, you probably wouldn't sense another person there, or maybe you would. I don't know. So is it possible that the person would be aware or could be aware under the right circumstances?
Oh, yeah, sure. In fact, one of the things that I personally would do in the hostage crises, the Lebanese hostage crises, is when we access people to find out their mental and emotional state, as well as their physical state, just sort of let them know that there was some comfort there, and that someone was with them, someone was sticking with them through it, and give them some comfort.
So they might just feel it as a sudden moment of unaccountable, otherwise, comfort.
Oh, yeah, you can cause that to happen. There are controls to let you cause that to happen, sure.
You see, just hearing this raises the hair on the back of my neck, because if you can do that, then there are so many things that, I mean, it would be hard to make an ethical argument for most exercises, if not almost all of them in that area. Hold tight. We're at the bottom of the hour. We'll be right back. We are going to the phones. Trust me.
There's something happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear.
The official website of Coast to Coast AM is www.coasttocoastam.com. Log on now.
I got to beware. I think it's time we stop. Children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. There's battle lines being drawn. Nobody's right if everybody's wrong. Young people.
I don't want your lonely mansion with a tear in every room. All I want's the love you promise beneath the haloed moon. But you think I should be happy. Silver threads and golden needles
talk with Art Bell. Call the Wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
You know, it's occurred to me that one of the reasons for the popularity of this program, something I've always wondered about, is the fact that people want there to be more to life than is apparent. They don't want everything explained. They don't want answers to everything. There's got to be some things you wonder about out there, or it would not be nearly so interesting, would it? I really like the Geico commercials, but I think it's because I have a perverted sense of humor, I guess. Lynn Buchanan is my guest, and we really are about to go to the telephone, so stay right where you are. Don't give up hope. I've been just one. I've got a fast blast here from, oh, what a surprise, Anonymous in L.A., California. Sex. Could you ask the question, please, Art? Have Lynn or others ever had sexual experiences while remote viewing? Oh, what the hell? I'm embarrassed to say I have, and it was quite stunning, says Anonymous. So, you know, it's an off-the-wall question, but, you know, why not?
Yeah, it's
Oh, no kidding.
It's really a valid question, but you can tell her that
this will bring many to the program, Lynn.
I might say darn it at this point, but you know, like I said before, we tended not to get anything we weren't tasked with. Somehow they never saw fit to task us with things like that, you know.
Yeah, I know, but if you were making up the list, I mean, now knowing, I guess, hearing your laugh, that certainly is indeed possible. Wow.
Well, yeah, if you have a bi-location experience, it's entirely possible. I don't know how much of it would be the target's experience rather than your own, but, you know.
You know, 90, in the high 90s, it seems to me, except, say, for, oh, I don't know, government work where we're spying on our enemies, whoever they might be. It's justified and, you know, morally and ethically and all the rest of it, you can justify it. But you know what? Not much else. Maybe helping find lost children and good stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But an awful lot of what you might do with remote viewing or influencing or bi-locating, ethics.
Sure.
Boy, ethics here.
Yeah, could you bi-locate into the women's shower? Well, of course you could, you know.
Yes.
And if that's the way you want to spend your time, then I guess you could say, you know, for entertainment purposes only. Or
well, you could. This will bring many. Well, you can stop right there. I mean,
sure.
I've never had anybody answer that question before. It's a beaut, and I appreciate it.
Yeah, it's actually a very good question. Like I say, there aren't any secrets anymore, even that, you know, mole that tries to keep being hidden can be seen.
All right, let's take some calls. I must. First time caller line, you're on the air with Lynn Buchanan. Hello.
Hello?
Hello.
Hey, Mr. Art. This is James. I do a line run from Colton to State Line, Nevada and back every night, and I get a chance to listen to you.
All right.
On the weekends and
yes, sir.
Mr. Norrie on the weekdays.
Yes, sir.
I just have a quick question for your guest. I was unfortunately just now able to get in to listen to you because my antenna was broken. I fixed it.
Okay.
He mentioned as I was driving that he had classes and students. Was he referring to he teaches classes on how to do this, or was he just saying that he teaches about it?
All right. Good. Good question, actually. Lynn, you're writing a book now, so that's
I'm working on a second book, and the first one is out already. and contains actually quite a bit of the training material in it as a reference section in the back. The answer is yes, I do teach the controlled remote viewing, but I teach the full course. I don't go into it when you sign on. Basically, I sign on to take you all the way from total novice to total master, if you're willing to go there.
Idiot to savant.
Absolutely. And it's a lot of work. We go into it at very great depth.
How long? How long is it?
The training class for the basic is 3 days, but then I send you home with exercises, targets. We keep in touch. We set you up on the database, and we database your work from there on out. You can come back for the basic course as many times as you want to at no cost after that for a refresher.
It's like repeating the fifth grade, though.
That's well, actually, no. There's a lot of material, and I haven't had anybody. Well, I've had a lot of people who've come 7, 8, 9 times.
Yeah, I was going to say, though, going all the way.
Oh, yeah. Going all the way through.
Yes.
Plan to spend at least a year on it, and that's if you work hard at it. If you make it your secondary thing, you know, and don't work hard at it, don't practice like you should, plan to spend at least 3 years on it.
This is serious work to do.
It's very serious work, yeah. And we have a graduated program where we teach you the basics first. We hope that you get the basics integrated into your system.
People always want to know this. How much?
$1,000 for each level of the course.
$1,000 for each level.
That's right. And I figure at that I'm making about $1.98 an hour because I'm spending generally around an average of around 300 hours after the class with each student. And so, you know, the 3 days of training is just the beginning 3 days where we teach you what to do from there on out. When certain things start happening in your sessions, those become mileposts that tell us when you're ready to come back for the intermediate class.
Is there anybody who ever approaches you, Lynn, who, how can I be gentle about this? You know that they're not right for this. Does that happen?
Absolutely.
It does. And how do you handle that?
I generally find out what they would like to do about it, you know, what they would like to do with it, and try to steer them to a trainer who will teach them along those lines.
Huh.
If they just want it shallow, then I keep up pretty well with the training that's going on out there.
By the way, speaking of shallow, Lynn, one of the influencing things, main things that can be proven is influencing computers. Yes?
Yeah.
All right. Well, you know, these machines in Las Vegas over the hill from me, even the ones here in town, for that matter, they've got them here. They're nothing but computers.
Yeah.
And, well, I'm not shallow how, but, you know, I do see the possibilities there and their financial possibilities. And could a person, boy, they're going to love to hear this downtown.
I happened to mention a while ago that I'm not in strong need of money, you know, that I'm not depending on my training
but if,
to get it.
Yes, but if?
I go to the money store every now and then.
The money store?
Otherwise known as Las Vegas.
Oh, you do?
Sure. I see nothing wrong with it. I mean, it provides a good living for my family, and sure, why not?
Oh. So then, is one... They're really going to love this? In town? I'm telling you. So you're telling me a person could stand in front of, let's say, a machine. Don't care. Poker machine, one-armed bandit.
Yeah. You know,
the lemons and the cherries and stuff.
Let me also explain that it's not as easy as it sounds.
Well, even if it's hard, it's going to worry them a lot, Lynn.
Oh, yeah, sure. and basically, you can't make it happen every time. It's not remote control. It's remote influencing.
Yes.
You can change the random hit rate.
Yes.
In your favor. Sure, you can do that, and you can walk away a winner.
And you can bring up sevens.
you can influence the randomness to where sevens will come up more often than they would otherwise, at a noticeable amount, so that you can come away a winner. Sure. Does that mean you're going to win every hand? No, absolutely.
Does that mean you're going to win a majority, though?
Sure, yeah.
Ha, ha, ha. Well, I wonder, of the new percentage of recruits who've listened the last 45 minutes or so, how many will be motivated by sex and how many by money? Wild Card Line, you're on the air with Lynn Buchanan. Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
My name's Chris. I'm calling from San Diego, California. First off, I'm a first-time caller, long-time listener. And I'm going to thank you, Art Bell, for all that you've done with this show.
Thank you.
I personally have, for the last year, have been deeply in a ritual practice on meditation. And I've been on my own on this, and I've had some experiences on my own that I haven't been able to explain and been on my own doing. And this is the first time that I've ever come close to anything that's kind of related to what I've gone through. So what I'm looking for here is just, I will share a brief experience and then maybe any advice or comments. A lot of the times when I go into my meditations, I get into a certain state, and I'm not doing this intentionally. I'm just focusing on my breathing, where when I close my eyes, I see black. And after a while, the blackness will dissolve, and I'll be in my living room, or I'll be at the local Starbucks where I've hung out. I've gone back to Tucson where I've seen friends of friends that I've never met, and I've confirmed certain things. I was able to confirm a friend that I never met, a car that they drove, and I described it to a T and later was there physically and was able to confirm it. And it's never been a point where I know I'm not leaving my body. I know I'm still in my apartment, and it always felt like reality was coming towards me.
All right, so what, do you have a question from all this?
I'm just trying to reach out and see where am I, is this what I'm experiencing sound like what remote viewing is?
Let me address three things that he said there. One, if you try to make it happen, it won't.
Yeah, I've never been able to. I've never tried to. The more I try, it just, so I let go.
Yeah,
and
that's right.
When I let go, it... And every time, even the little voice in my head says, oh, I'm at this place. Like last night, I was down at the corner, at my street corner, at the gas station. I said, oh, I'm at the Texaco gas station.
Sure.
Automatically, yeah. It disappeared.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it will. The more you try to capture it, the further away it seems to get. Second, the experience you had there is, could be what Inga Swann calls spontaneous remote viewing. It happens to you. Once you get good at spontaneous remote viewing, it will happen even when you're not totally in a meditative state. And so practicing this, meditation is a fantastic way to get in touch with yourself, with your inner self, and it's a good practice.
But isn't it a sort of a general thing where you're opening your consciousness damn near randomly?
Sure.
As opposed to any direction which would be supplied by remote viewing. Or...
And he has no control over where he goes. Generally, he will go to familiar places and familiar people. And this happens quite a bit with the spontaneous remote viewing. You have to add controls to this process in order to target some specific place and have control over it. The third thing I wanted to say was that in controlled remote viewing especially, we sort of build a mini virtual reality with stress on the reality. And it becomes real to us, and yet unlike, say, out-of-body experiences where a part of you goes to the site,
mm-hmm.
and people have actually been witnessed at the site, in the controlled remote viewing, you're building a mini virtual reality where your subconscious supplies you with all the information in visuals, smells, tastes, textures, and all that. And this is one of the reasons why in controlled remote viewing, you can never be picked up at the site. You can never be noticed there or even sensed there by dogs or animals or anything, is because you're not going there. The site is coming to you. And so this is, the experiences you're having are all very well in line with the process.
Lynn, I've had a really clear, unmistakable case of precognition in my life. One.
Is that all?
And that's all.
Oh, really?
And really?
That's uncommon.
But it was a whopper, and it was waking hours and everything else,
yeah.
And it was really, really strong, and it really, really happened. In fact, when my car got hit, I fell to my knees watching it happen because I was driven to this window to watch. I knew something was going to happen to my car. Sure as hell, guy got in front, started his ignition, threw it in reverse, hit my car while I was watching because I knew he was going to hit my car. I actually went to my window of this apartment. So it was random that I didn't want it. I didn't bring it on. I couldn't do it again if my life depended on it, and probably even less if my life depended on it. So can you actually control these things? Do you think that a discipline like remote viewing can become so sharp that it can start to control what's natural for you sometimes?
Oh, yeah.
Or even
it
extremely.
Takes work, it takes practice. And here again, what you experienced was what Ingo calls spontaneous remote viewing. And, and you know, it's just another name for precognition. You were basically, your mind was giving you information about something 1 minute in the future.
Boy, was it ever. It was like
yeah.
ocean waves washing over me. Someone's
yeah.
going to hit your car. You're going to hit your car. I went to the window once, and nobody was there out there, and I said, this is stupid, and went back to watch the evening news, and washed over me again, same thing, until it was forced me back to the window, and I watched this guy walk down the sidewalk, get in his car, put it in reverse, hit my car.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I actually fell to my knees. It scared me so badly. Nothing like that's ever happened again. But
oh,
it
really?
Sure did happen once.
I'm surprised that it never happened again. It's a much more common experience than most people realize. And a lot of times it happens simply as a life preservation type thing.
Unless you're talking about decisions that we make in life. I tend to make fairly good decisions about what to do next in life.
Yeah,
and a lot of that, I suppose, is intuition when you're faced with a question about direction in your life. Intuition takes over and says, here's what I should be doing.
Sure.
Listen, your book, The Seventh Sense, exciting about remote viewing, available generally now, I would assume, in all the usual suspected places.
That's right. And
Amazon.
Being a first-time author, Simon & Schuster didn't really pushed the book, and so it wound up not being on a lot of shelves. And I was talking to Jim Mars one day, and he said, what you do is you advise people that if they have to order the book, order two or three of them, and then when they come in, say, oh, I only need one now, and the other two wind up on the shelf.
So it can be ordered, and it's probably up on Amazon, right?
That's right. It's
All
on
right.
Amazon,
That's
and it's
good
on
enough.
Our website as well.
All right. So you, either way, we're out of time, Lynn. It was a blast.
Thank you very much.
It really was. Oh, you're a great guest. Thank you, Lynn, and good night.
Good night. Thank you.
That's it, folks. We are out of time. See you tomorrow night when the saga continues, the saga of all that other stuff in life. From the high desert, I'm Art Bell.
This year was all about drama.
high desert in the great American Southwest. I bid you good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be on the planet, all its wonderful time zones covered by this program. I'm Art Bell, and this program is Coast to Coast AM. Glad to be here. It's the weekend, hooray! And it's going to be an extremely interesting program this evening. Next hour, Lynn Buchanan, very famous remote view viewer instructor, very famous remote viewer, period, from the government CIA-sponsored program. Lynn Buchanan, one of the greats. And in this hour, we're going to have open lines. That's coming up. But a few things first. I've got a little homegrown weirdness for you. I mean, really homegrown. This involves me and some friends of mine. And fortunately, it's just not me that's going to be telling the story. I've got her here. You know her. Her name is Bonnie Crystal. At least a lot of you probably know her. She's the very unusual lady who traveled to Peru and travels to different parts of the world looking for the deepest holes in the world to climb down into. In fact, one time we talked to her by satellite phone in Peru when she was about to descend into one of the aforementioned holes. Anyway, something truly bizarre happened yesterday, and I guess I was part of it. So in a moment, we'll tell you all about it. This would be a superb time to ask you all what you know about missing time. That's right, missing time. Time that just is gone. Now, here's a little homegrown weirdness for you. Bonnie Crystal and her business partner, Jessica, were on the way from, you know, they're friends of mine. They were on the way from the Bay Area, where they live, down to Las Vegas, here to Las Vegas, to go to the CES show, as so many other electronic junkies are doing right now. It's going on in Las Vegas with all the electronic goodies. And so I was talking to Bonnie, who, of course, is a ham radio operator, on the 40-meter band, and I was kind of talking her in. You know, I think I got her from the time she pretty much left home until she got here, actually, came to Pahrump And so, right in the middle of our conversation, I guess Bonnie and I were talking. Bonnie, welcome to the program. When were you and I chatting? You were just getting to a high point, weren't you?
Right. Hi, Art, and greetings, everybody. It was the day before yesterday, in the afternoon, midday, and we were traveling from the central part of California over the mountains at Tehachapi towards Las Vegas and Pahrump area.
Right.
And we got to the top of the mountain, and they have the big wind farm plant there where they have windmills generating electric power.
Yeah, it's incredible, actually.
And we saw all the windmills, and as we got to the top, we were talking with you on the ham radio.
It was you and Jess in your car, right?
Right.
And yeah, you and I were talking on ham radio.
And then you got off for a few moments.
Ramona came in and gave me some lunch. I said, I'm going to get a bite to eat. And so we signed temporarily. And I said, I'd be back in a few minutes. And then I guess the next time I heard you was easily an hour, maybe more than an hour later. Suddenly, there you were. I had been looking for you. I had been calling you, but suddenly, there you were. And so, what happened?
Well, it seemed like only a few minutes to me. But it ended up being 45 minutes or an hour later. And the funny thing is, you can be driving somewhere and not realize that you passed an exit or something like that. But this particular instance, Jessica and I both realized it at the exact same time.
You realized that you had lost an hour.
And somehow we got transported to a place further away than we were actually headed to.
How much further?
Well, it was at least 45 miles or 50 miles away.
Plus, you passed a place where you normally would have stopped for gas and all the rest of it? I mean, where you actually probably planned to stop for gas, right?
Yes, we planned to stop for gas in a little town called Mojave.
Right.
And just so happens that at that particular town they have stoplights and you have to make a left turn. And there's usually a lot of truck traffic and that sort of thing and traffic in town.
So in other words, if you were subject to some sort of road hypnosis, hitting that would have snapped you out of it anyway. I mean, you know, if you're kind of hypnotized by the road and you don't realize where you are, okay, fine. People can imagine that as a cause for what we're talking about right now. But that this would have pulled you out of that quick because you would have had to stop and notice everything around you.
Yes, and it would have had to make a, you know, slow down to a stop and make a left turn across traffic in order to get on the other road. And we don't remember anything about that. And the funny thing about it is that we both remember nothing during that period of time.
So in other words, from the moment or a moment or two after I spoke to you on the radio and we signed, and then just like a minute later, you were how far down the road?
50 miles down the road.
50 miles down the road. And I guess you looked at each other and said, at the same time, what?
Well, the first thing we noticed was a landmark on the side, which was a new solar energy plant that they built out in the desert there.
Right.
And we thought, have they built another one before you get to Mojave? We knew that you had one down the road past Mojave and on the way to Barstow. But here they built this new plant since the last time we've come through here. Then we realized we were not where we thought we were, because all of a sudden we started seeing landmarks for a little place called Kramer Junction.
Kramer Junction.
And we said to ourselves, how can we be in Kramer Junction? Kramer Junction is after Mojave. And it was right at that time that we heard you on the radio and talked to you on the ham radio.
And the first thing I think someone asked me was, hey, something just happened to us out here. Something like that. It was you or Jess. Is Jess there with you?
Yeah, she's here with me now.
Put her on for just a sec.
Okay, Jessica.
Hi, Art.
Hi, Jessica.
Hi.
Okay, so your account of this experience, roughly the same, of course, but you both realized this at the same time?
We realized it when we went by the power plant, and I said to Bonnie, I said, how far up the road is Mojave? And she said, well, it's just up the road a bit. And then we turned up to Kramer Junction, and I said, wait a minute, Kramer Junction is after. Oh, my God, what happened to Mojave? And then you came on the air, and I think I told you, Art, something very strange has just happened.
Yeah. And so, Jessica, what do you think happened to you?
I have no idea. I'm a physicist, so I'm supposed to understand these things. And the strange thing is that Bonnie and my memories of getting off the radio with you ended at the same time, and our memories of the power plant started at the same time, and I was fully awake. I was watching the scenery, waiting for Mojave to come along to gas up and get a soda. And it just absolutely no memory. It's like someone cut that 45 minutes out of my life.
You're not a strong believer in the paranormal, are you?
No, I'm not. I believe in the physics of the world, and
yes,
things are supposed to operate a certain way. They're not
yes
supposed to happen like this.
Uh-huh. But they do, and they
happened.
Did. And it happened the day before yesterday.
And it shook me up, as you remember when I was talking to you on the radio. It was a definitely earth-shaking experience. This stuff's not supposed to happen.
But it does, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. I can attest to that now, and right now I'm getting goosebumps telling you.
Well, I appreciate the two of you coming on there. They had to go grab a hotel room telephone somewhere or another in order to come on the air and even tell this story. They're in Las Vegas at the CES show. How is the CES show? Is it really cool?
Packed with people. It's very interesting. Video is definitely the hot thing. HDTV is everywhere. And as you know, with your new HDTV, everyone's going to have one in a couple of years.
It'll happen. Just as black and white went to color, this will happen.
And it's a stunning difference from color.
Oh, yes. Well, I want to thank you, and I want to thank Bonnie for coming on the air, and it'll probably spark a conversation. I have no idea what happened to that time, where you might have been. You've checked your body, haven't you?
Yes. That's the first thing I thought was, in fact, I think I mentioned to you,
because yeah,
something like weird happened in the middle of the afternoon along a highway, because it's wasn't even nighttime.
Yeah, in broad daylight, to individuals who pride ourselves on being scientists.
We're scientists. This stuff doesn't happen to us. We hear about this, but to experience it is spooky. And I'm sure some of your listeners have experienced this also.
It's even in reflection now, the two of you don't think it's possible that just some simple old road hypnosis could have done this.
I wasn't watching the road. I wasn't hypnotized by anything.
Yeah, and the other thing is, Bonnie was speaking with me, so there was a lot of external stuff going on.
And we were both well-rested, and we both just had lunch, and it's the middle of the day. Those are not hypnosis periods. You know, in the evening, on a lonely road at night, you can understand that.
Yeah, I'm with you. Well, congratulations, and welcome to the club, both of you.
There's more things in heaven and earth, right?
I guess so. Thanks. And good night. That's Bonnie Crystal. And Jessica, and I'll tell you, we'll hear from Bonnie again. She's going back down to Peru. She's a caver, on top of doing what she does in Silicon Valley. She's a caver and looks for truly the deepest holes in the world. But there was an experience worth hearing about. Now, I had my little part in it, in that I was talking to them and noted the passage of that amount of time, certainly, and called them, and they weren't there. The question is, where were they, or when were they, or whatever? So maybe some of the rest of you have had some sort of experience with something like this. I don't know. But I thought I would toss it out for what it's worth, and it is certainly worth something. Quickly around the world, British soldiers and Iraqi police clashed Saturday with armed stone-throwing protesters in South Eastern Iraq, killing six people. U.S. officials unfortunately acknowledge that American soldiers mistakenly killed two Iraqi policemen after they failed to properly identify themselves, and in Fallujah, all nine soldiers aboard the helicopter, the medevac helicopter that we now know was shot down. Did not fall down. Well, it did, but it was shot down. An American Airlines commuter flight diverted Saturday, another one, after a passenger passed a note to the crew demanding to be taken to Australia. The plane landed safely instead at Washington's Dulles Airport. It's cold in the Northeast. While the climate change is real, certainly I'm sure that the people in the Northeast don't want to hear about you're going to hear about it, though, global warming. It's very cold right now. NASA's Spirit rover has now fully unfolded itself and stretched up to its full 4'11" height. That's a small person, I guess, making it ready to drive off the lander that has delivered it to Mars. And the rover space agency says it might reach the Martian surface as soon as Wednesday morning. Now, we've got to talk about Mars for a second. There's good news, and then I guess maybe some bad news. I don't know. A data acquired on Mars from the Mars rover Spirit's mini thermal emission spectrometer shows that light or spectral signatures of an as-of-yet unidentified material that contains bound water. That's water, folks, in its crystal structure. Minerals such as gypsum and zeolites are possible candidates. If water is indeed bound inside crystals underground, well, then it once flowed freely on the surface. Meaning there's a very large chance there once was, and maybe still is, life on Mars. Now, there's something that I want to say here, which will probably be not good news for Richard Hoagland. I've really spent my time on the Enterprise mission site, and I have looked at all of what I could find of what were considered to be anomalous photographs, and there is one thing of a snake maybe. It sort of looks like a snake, or an animal like a snake with its mouth open and eyes and stuff, right? But I got to tell you, what I mostly see up there are rocks. Five rocks. I could nearly go into my backyard here or very close by and take a photograph out here in the desert and show you a similar scene. Now, you know, I don't want to step on any toes here, but I don't see it, baby. I just don't see it. I see weird-shaped things. But when you have a field full of, or even a horizon full of weird rocks and shapes and things on Mars, you're going to end up with stuff that looks like stuff. I mean, it's really akin, in my opinion, to looking at the clouds and finding your little puppy dog up there. Ooh, look at your puppy dog. You know, it's like that. You can find things in things, and when they're not fully distinct, and when they're only partially distinct, and they are awfully good photographs, but, you know, by the time you get down to rocks and stuff like that, you begin to get a little fuzzy, and if you look at those photographs, I guess you can see things in them that that you want to see. I mean, the mind does that. Now, I know there will be strong, strong protests from the ever passionate, very passionate, verbose Richard C. Hoagland. But I've looked very carefully, and I'm sorry, I see rocks. Now, that doesn't negate the possibility there's life on Mars, certainly, and now with the discovery of water, it's ever so likely there is or was. Probably both. But I don't think we landed in the middle of a machine shop or wreckage of a civilization, which I've seen some evidence of in satellite photographs that look below the immediate topography on the top of Mars. I'm willing to say those are very suspicious, but these new photographs from the rover, wonderful as they are, look like rocks. Now, there is some weird stuff there, you know, where the rover hit, you know, it boom, 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 bounced, right? And apparently, where it bounced, it exposed soil that was stripped up and folded in a very interesting way, according to Jim Bell, a spokesman, right? The scientists just can't wait to get there. They want to dig into the area where the rover bounced. They say, quote, it's bizarre. Steve Squire said that, principal investigator on the NASA team. It's strangely cohesive. It's not like anything I've ever seen before. It's weird stuff. That's a quote. So there's plenty of interesting stuff to explore in this crater on Mars. But once again, being absolutely honest with you and Richard and everybody else concerned, honestly, I've looked and I've looked at the photographs, and yes, you can see shapes. I mean, given millions of rocks, and there are obviously millions of rocks there, right? There's going to be some weird-shaped rocks. Hell, I can go out in my backyard here and go to Death Valley, and you can get a scene just about like that, and you can come up, you go, ooh, look at that, and it's a really oddly shaped rock. And in a photograph, as you look at images and blow them up and do all the rest of that, you begin to get images that the mind will then attach meaning to, because that's what the mind tries to do when it looks at any image. It tries to attach a meaning to it. It's the human thing to do. We have brains, and our brains go to work, and they try and recognize something in the incoherent madness that's out there. That's what minds do. It looks for something it recognizes. And beyond that, I see nothing. Nothing but rocks and rocks and rocks. I'm Art Bell, and this is Coast to Coast AM.
On a shoulder, the sun is setting like molasses.
everybody. Remember, the phone numbers change on the weekends. You know, the week has some phone numbers, and we share some with the week, and then we have other ones on the weekend. So listen very carefully.
To talk with Art Bell, call the Wild Card line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
It is, and we'll go to the phones shortly and see what you have to think about all this. Those are the numbers. Stay right where you are. Open lines directly. And now, from the high desert into the gene pool we jump. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Yes, I was looking at the latest images from Mars.
Ah, yes.
And I found three of the images that looked like they had something like a UFO in the air.
A UFO in the air?
Yeah.
On Mars?
Definitely.
Okay.
And I'd like to have somebody explain it. I just...
Well, I would too. I haven't seen, I can't say that I've seen what you're talking about, but...
Okay. I can tell you how to go there.
Well, send me an email.
Okay. Sent you one of the fast things, anyway.
A fast blast.
Yeah.
All right. Well, is it in there? Is the URL in there?
No, I don't know how to do that on my computer.
But, oh. Okay. Anyway, well, all you have to do is right-click and hit copy. And then go to Fast Blast or anywhere else and right-click again and hit paste. And boom, it'll appear.
Okay.
All right?
Well, I'll do that. Thank you very much.
That's a quick lesson in how to transfer a URL. Copy and paste. Right-click. Wildcard line, you are on the air. Hello.
Hello?
Hi.
Hi. I was wondering if anybody called in. You had an explanation for that Bonnie with where her 50 minutes went.
And where, pray tell, did her 50 minutes go?
Well, Highway 58 between Barstow and Tehachapi doesn't go into Mojave anymore. You got to exit off Highway 14 to get into Mojave.
Really?
Now they completed a bypass.
Oh, really?
That whole highway was under construction, and she's right about when she was going by the windmills there on Tehachapi.
Yes.
Well, about 45 minutes later, Wood put her about the truck stop there at Kramer Junction.
Well, maybe that's where her runaway hour or whatever went.
Well, the first time it happened to me, that whole area was under construction.
Well, you know,
I came up with...
Ma'am, I've got a... you're in a truck right now, I take it, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I've got a friend who's a truck driver, and we were talking with him as well yesterday, and what really scared me was... His name is Tim, friend of mine, and he was down in New Mexico at the time, involved in the conversation to some degree, and he said, oh, yeah, that happens to me sometimes, too.
Well, yeah, all of a sudden, when you're going, when it first happened to me, I was going westbound toward Bakersfield, and all of a sudden, I seen a scale house, and I thought, well, what the hell happened to Mojave?
Yeah, no, I don't mean so much that exact thing, but missing time. Have you ever had missing time?
Occasionally, not often.
Occasionally, but even so, like as I told Tim, that's a little scary. If people in 18-wheelers, you know, the big ones, are missing time, then what the hell's a truck doing in between? Well, maybe that's the answer, a bypass. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. I keep having these occurring disappearances. For instance, a couple of weeks ago, I had something on the top of my medicine cabinet. I have three shelves there.
Yes.
I had a plastic little handle that fell off the mirror. I kept it there for a long time.
And then, what are you saying? Poof, it was just gone?
Well, what happened is I went to reach for a pair of scissors next to it. I got the scissors, and the object fell. It never hit bottom. I saw it go down. Till this day, I can't find it. And this is not the first time these things have happened. I've lost a button off my coat in my hallway. The kitchen was ripped apart because of renovation, and even the radiator was taken apart, and I figured, oh, maybe now I'll find my button.
Well, I must admit, things do disappear, and they seem to go to the land of the lost, but then occasionally, some years, like you'll move something, sofa or something that you haven't moved in years, and you look behind it, and you go, oh, wow, look! Well, that's where it went.
Well, that's what I thought about the button that fell off my coat a few years ago. They ripped the whole kitchen apart because they were renovating. The counters went, the radiator went. I figured I would find my button then.
No
button. Nothing. Never to be found, ever.
Gotcha. Well, then, see, maybe on the other side of the coin, things do disappear. I mean, they just disappear. What do you suppose might occur to them? Maybe they slip into a little tiny hole into another dimension where they're never going to be found again. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Cheerio.
Yeah, hello, Art.
Hi.
This is Michael, listening to 550 KFYI in Phoenix.
Yo, Michael.
I wanted to call about the debris field around the rover.
Yes.
And, you know, I don't have a computer. I haven't seen the latest pictures, but I've been listening every night and had heard everyone describe what's there and
right.
Great detail.
Oh, yes.
And I've come to a conclusion as to what it is.
Well, but that's awfully early for you to come to a, I mean, without...
Well, I may have a new outlook on this, though.
Okay, I'm listening.
Okay, well, it's, with all due respect to Richard, I think that is debris from the Earth. And I believe that what it is where, over all these years, all of our lost airline luggage has been going.
So we're back to the lost again. Yeah, and maybe a few other things, too. Who knows? Maybe they go to Mars.
Well, you know that skull? That could, if you've ever seen a Beagle skull.
Yeah.
And that grid there, that could just be a rusting...
Well, here's the challenge that I think that I'm going to do, and I've been threatening to do this for a long time. I live out here in the middle of the desert, right?
Uh-huh.
And trust me when I tell you that nearby is Death Valley, and I'm telling you right now, I could take pictures of parts of Death Valley that would not be different than what you're seeing right now.
Oh, yeah, Robinson Crusoe on Mars, the movie.
And I'm darn well thinking of doing it. And then picking out little bunny rabbits and hammers and buzzsaws and stuff like that.
Oh, I agree. I live in the desert, too. I desert rab at times, and you're right.
So I'm going to do that. Thank you. As a test, I'm going to do that. I'm going to take a picture. And as I was saying at the bottom of the hour, with all good deference to Richard, I think people see what they want to see. And then if I were to say to you, oh, look, there is a picture of a hammer lying there right in the middle of the Martian desert, and it did look like a hammer, then your brain would look at it and say, whoa, hammer. And so having looked at the photographs myself, I mean, I didn't go just on comments received at all. I looked very carefully at all the photographs. And yes, of course, you can begin to see shapes. The human mind forces you to do that because you're trying to identify something. And so, hallelujah, you do. And so I understand how it's happening. But honest to goodness, looking objectively, I can't go, wow, that's not a rock. I'm telling you, I see rocks. International Line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. How are you doing tonight?
I'm just fine. How are you?
I'm pretty good. I actually had a question. I was surfing around the internet a couple nights ago, and I came across this guy's site, William Cooper.
Bill Cooper, yes.
Who is this guy? Why?
Well, in the past, Bill Cooper is dead.
Oh, is he?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Yeah, because he didn't have a lot of nice things to say about you.
Oh, I'm well aware. He thought that I was involved with the secret government. Let's see, the secret government. He thought that I was a Freemason and a lot of other stuff. All kinds of things he thought about me. And as evidence, he cited a triangle with an eye in it that somebody wants to put up on my website.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. I saw that Art Bell.
Yes, so all I can say is, like the rocks on Mars, I guess you'll believe what you hear, or not. Anyway, that story on Bill Cooper. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, how you doing, Art?
I'm doing okay.
Well, this is Karen, and I'm a truck driver, too.
Uh-huh.
And the other lady took the words right out of my mouth about Tehachapi.
The bypass.
Right. The same thing happened to me. I got 20 miles down the road and realized where's Mojave?
What happened to Mojave?
Yeah, what happened to Mojave? But I was going over, taking a friend home, going back towards Palmdale there. But I've had a few strange things happen. I remember on your past shows you talked about Mandela.
Oh, well, yes, that a lot of people have the memory that Nelson Mandela died.
That I don't remember, but during that time period in the 70s, when I graduated from high school, we had a teacher that I swear up and down had died, and I went to her funeral.
Oh.
10 years later, we had a class reunion, and I was discussing this with one of the students. I said, boy, we're really going to miss her, and next thing I knew, she walked in.
That's got to be a little unsettling.
And I think it was during that same time, and that has been bothering me for years until I heard that show, one of your shows a couple years ago or a year ago,
about this phenomena. Well, it's actually, thank you, it's actually a lot deeper than that because of what it would mean. And here's the basic theory, that a lot of people, for example, have the memory that Nelson Mandela did not... not serve his jail time and then get out and go on to lead South Africa, but rather died. And it's not just that. That's just one example. There are many other examples of seemingly false memories that people have. Now, what could these be? Well, if there is eventually to be time travel, and I believe there will be, if we live, if we survive as a race to gain the technology, I think we'll be able to travel in time. I really believe that. And so there could be time travelers. And it may well be that if they in some way tamper with the fabric of time, or there's some other anomaly that tampers itself with the fabric of time, then things perhaps do get switched on about as experimentation and tampering occurs. And things occur one way, and then time makes them something else. And so we have these weird little memories. Just a possibility. Wildcard line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes. Yes, Michael from Waterville.
Yes, Michael.
I happen to be listening in on the Mars thing.
Yes.
And I was intrigued. I brought up my computer.
Yes.
And a lot of those things look like just faces that are like from some statue that fell over or something.
Yeah.
It's over to the right, there were some that looked like they got a long nose and a kind of a flat helmet instead of a round helmet.
Right.
And that little snake-like thing looks more like it's a pipe from a tractor or something because...
Yeah, I mean, you're right. See, we could go on with this until the time itself ends. So you're sort of with me. I mean, it looks like this, it looks like that, it looks like a lot of things, and that's what our brain does. It tries to take random images and make sense out of them. So, I'm just not convinced, that's all. To me, I think they're rocks.
I like the gears behind that little snake-like thing.
I appreciate the call, sir. Thank you. I know... I looked at the snake-like thing, and I don't know. Rocks. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hey.
Hey.
About lost time.
Yes, sir.
One time I drank 2/5 of whiskey, and I lost 2 days.
Well, that, of course, is a self-inflicted time loss, isn't it, sir?
It certainly was. Thanks.
You're very welcome, and... try and stay with us. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello. This is Olin in Culver City, California.
Yes, Olin.
A couple years ago, you had a heavy windstorm in Pahrump, Nevada, and it was bringing in dust and dirt from Mongolia and the...
That's a fact, yes.
And the Gobi Desert.
Yep.
Now, that's the same kind of land deflation that they're seeing there in that Mars crater. And if the dust has been blown away in the Mars crater to expose buried objects, then there must also be some exposed buried objects in Mongolia and in that Gobi Desert. Now, David Childress has been on your program a couple times, and
yes,
he explores places like that.
Mm-hmm.
And now, with all of that deflation in Mongolia and the Gobi Desert, there might be a few artifacts or dinosaur eggs or something to find there in the Gobi Desert.
Well, you know, they do look, for example, for meteorites, and they go to dry lake beds and places like that to look for meteorites or anything else because, yes, indeed, there's a great deal of exposure that occurs just due to wind and dust erosion. And besides, that kind of empty area is just a good place. A meteorite would stand out. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Wow, really?
Yes, wow, really.
Well, this is Brad in Davenport, Iowa. Is this Art?
Yeah, see, Brad, we don't screen calls, so you just go on the air just like you just did.
Wow, amazing.
Mm.
Well, you know, I was calling. It's kind of a weird question. I'm a logical person. I don't know, I have a tendency to doubt some of the things I hear on the show, but I figure you, of all people, would probably have a good answer for this. What do you call having a dream about something and then a period of time later actually seeing it?
Or I would probably call that precognition.
That's precognition.
Yes.
Well, I mean, I guess I'm a skeptic and everything. I'm in law enforcement. You know, I sometimes think I'm losing my mind, but I have dreams periodically. They're nothing significant. It's, you know, not the death of anybody. It's nothing important. It's almost random.
Well, like life, you would think that would be the case more times than not of a precognitive dream. Why would it always be of dramatic events? It might just be of an event, something.
Right.
Yeah.
And I had one here the other day that was just, you know, like I said, I'm in law enforcement. It's damn scary, to be quite honest. Because it's like, what comes next? It's like two pictures that are out of focus.
All right, what was it?
It was, well, I can't really go into it a great deal because it was on the job. But basically, I was at a location. You know, the dream when I had it was nothing significant. It's nothing that I remembered. You know, I had very lucid dreams.
Right.
It was nothing significant. But when the day came and it happened, it was literally like two images coming into perfect crystal clear focus. Everything made sense. I recognized the individual I was speaking with. The truck, I had a book, a log book on the truck. I mean, I recognized the location, which is a very unique location. It's a secure location. I mean, it was absolutely amazing. And it's like, am I losing my mind here? Is this something that I could learn to control?
Do you talk to your partner? Have you mentioned this to your partner, to others in the department?
I mentioned this to my partner, yeah.
You did?
And he's actually my twin brother.
How did he handle it?
I asked him, you know, I said, hey, you know, I want to ask you something here, and don't think I'm nuts, but have you ever had a dream and then seen it? He's like, yeah. And it was the most casual thing.
Well, it's because the human brain can do stuff like this. I mean, it's a fact. I gotta go. The hour's ending. Thank you very much.
Not a problem.
All right. So there's a police officer, and you know, it's the police, and everybody has these experiences. There is much more to this life than is apparent on the surface, isn't there? And even policemen and firemen and public officials, they all know it. We just don't talk about it, except right here.